approaches, please sit down. Before we commence this business, now please ask everyone to stand to observe a minute of silence to pay respect to the victims of yesterday's attack. The rest of us. Item 1 on the agenda is public questions. Question 1, is Mr. Myers in attendance? Yes, Mr. Myers? Okay, can we take our questions being read? Councillor Brendan, would you like to respond?
Thank you, Chair. The vast majority of businesses in North Tyneside will see no increase or a small reduction in the cost of NDR, the result of the 2017 revaluation business rates. Second part of the question is, the overall fall in the value of business rates was reflected in the budget proposals agreed by the full council in February. The fall in the rates being offset by an increase in the total grant the authority will receive from central government during 2017-2018.
Thank you. Questions 2 and 3 which we'll take together. Is Mrs. Eckford in attendance? Okay, we'll take our questions being read. And is Miss Ford in attendance? Okay, we'll take our questions being read. Councillor Dodd, would you like to respond, please?
Thank you, Chair. You recognise that tourism is an important part of North Tyneside. The 5.5 million business, bringing in £279 million spent, supporting over 3,700 jobs. It is for this reason we are continuing to invest in making North Tyneside a great place to visit, including the delivery of our £36 million course of regeneration master plan. However, in the face of extreme challenging financial situation, it makes sense to consider how technology and trends in business behaviour can be embraced to reduce the pressures on our budget and develop visitor information provision that's fit for the future. The number of visitors to our tourism website, Visit North Tyneside, has increased by 350% in 4 years, and our surfing and time of app has been downloaded over 3,000 times. And we all know the influence of TripAdvisor has become. The changes in the way we, which people access information, there is less need to visit an actual building. Visitors can now access information online if they need, wherever they are. In fact, our Visit North Tyneside page attracted, as I said, 2,000 visitors in 2016. The audience measures proven successful. We are now taking our tourism information to our visitors rather than relying on business looking for the building based on the right case, especially as some visitors make it straight to their destination rather than visiting the Tourist Information Centre. However, it is important to know that closing the building doesn't mean that we are not going to speak to people. We will continue to have face-to-face consultations with business, with our business partners and volunteers, providing a welcome service to all 18 transit cruise ships between April and September this year. Again, taking information directly to business. We will also continue to work with local business with more North Tyneside as a destination of choice. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Councillor Dodd. We're going to take questions 4, 5, 6 and 7 together. Let's start with question four. Paul, do you want to see a question or Tim is there?
Tim is there.
Okay, is Miss Marshall here?
Yes.
Want to see a question or Tim is there?
Tim is there, please.
Thank you. Mr. Johnson?
Present. Take the bed, please.
Oh, thank you. And Miss Johnson as well. Tim is there? Thank you. Can I ask Councillor Pearson to respond, please?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Chair. Yes, in answering all four questions, I understand that this is a really important time for parents, children, when they choose their new school. And every year, admission authorities are required to determine their admission arrangements in accordance with the school admissions code. We do this annually in consultation with schools. Any changes, if there are any changes proposed, we have to have a formal consultation, like a legal process, and we would consult with parents, schools, neighbouring local authorities and all interested parties. Just to clarify, there have been no changes to catchment areas, as I think parents are well aware, because they say it in the question, for well over 30 years. So I think this clearly dispels any myth that there's been a conspiracy theory. The catchment areas haven't been changed for over 30 years. Other factors, similarly, there have been no changes to the pupil admission numbers, referred to commonly as the PAM, for many years. In fact, we think since probably about 2000-2002, so for over 15 years, the pupil admission numbers to schools has been the same. A George Stevenson High School's PAM has been 228 and has offered places to 228 pupils according to the previously agreed oversubscription criteria. This is the first time in a number of years that this had to be applied. And previously it hadn't had to be applied, and I am aware that previously children from Greenhills Estate have gone into George Stevenson when George Stevenson wasn't full. But just to clarify, there have been no changes to the PAN number either for many years. Also, there have been no changes to the oversubscription criteria. And the opposite, this is only used when a school admits to its maximum number, which is what George Stevenson High School have done this year. With regard to admission numbers, the DfE provided a formula in around about 2001 how to calculate appropriate admission numbers for a school. They take into account the size, the age of the pupils, the general areas available, the light practical areas like IT, science, textiles, heavy practical areas like PE, engineering, and larger performance areas for assemblies, drama, music. And there's a calculation and a formula made, and say this formula came in from the DfE in 2001. George Stevenson High School is within this criteria, the number that is proposed. North Tyneside has over 94% of good and outstanding schools and is in the top 10 local authorities within the country on performance. And also, for Year 7 pupils, North Tyneside achieved 94.29% first choice preferences this year and regularly performs in the mid 90% on first choice preferences. The national percentage is 84% and North Tyneside is in the top 10% of performing in this area for offering first choice places to schools, combined with a very high percentage of good and outstanding schools to choose from. However, so that's some general information, Chair. I do appreciate how disappointed it is for those families not offered their first choice and they are here tonight. On the specific points in the questions, on question four regarding the local plan, hasn't actually been implemented yet, and it's gone through its final stage of consultation and will be implemented and come into force later in 2017, so later this year. So therefore no houses have been built as a result of the local plan. And also for information, the strategic site on the Killingworth Moor, which is in the local plan, and as proposed in the local plan, that actual dot development is actually located within the Long Benton High School catchment area. The local plan, which will come into effect in 2017 and could last 15 years to 2032, will propose a 900 place secondary school, which will be to serve the Killingworth and surrounding areas, as well as an additional primary school for that area and an additional primary school for the Merton Gap area. It is true, question number five, it is true that a small number of pupils this year from Greenhills Estate have not gone into George Stevenson High School, and previously pupils from this area have, because George Stevenson was not admitted to its maximum number. but there are no current plans to review the catchment areas or the admission numbers. I think that's partly asked for in question 7 as well, Chair. We will keep it under review, and if we do consider any changes, as I've said, we would have to go through a formal consultation, and it would be, in effect, the changes to any proposals would be a year's hence because of the formal process that we have to go through and everybody that we have to consult. So all of the criteria have been in place for years, consulted on, and that's not advice of the DMA and things. If and when a new school is built, catchment areas would have to be reviewed. Clearly, when the new school in the secondary school in the Killingworth area was introduced, there would need to be a review of the catchment areas. With regard to question 6, in year 5 admissions for September 2018, I have received an analysis of the current year 5 in the George Stevenson High School catchment area. And on current information and a couple of assumptions, I will explain the assumptions, pupils from within the George Stevenson High School catchment area do not fill George Stevenson High School to capacity in September 2018. And you clearly want to know what the assumptions are. The assumptions would be that those year 5 pupils currently in middle schools, faith schools and special schools would continue because there's no transfer from a middle school in year 5, and those who've chosen faith schools presumably will continue to choose faith schools, and those who do need special education schools would presumably still require special. So on the assumption that middle schools, faith schools and special school pupils in year 5 remain in those categories of school, the current numbers would not fill up to the capacity of George Stevenson for next year's year 5. Obviously, there's no guarantees, and that is the information is only as good as the information the day you get it, because we have parental preference and parents can make any choice that they wish. And I did say that we will keep this under review. I've had one meeting with senior officers, and I've got further meetings in the next couple of weeks as well. With regard to question 7, it is true Greenhills Estate is not in George Stevenson High School catchment and never has been. The boundary being the A1056. And already mentioned, the Killingworth Moor site for the local plan is in the Longbenton catchment area. And as previously stated, there are no current plans to review the catchment area, but we will keep this under review. Myself and the Mayor are very concerned about the quality of education in North Tyneside. Hence, we support a full school improvement service and work collaboratively with all schools. Hence, North Tyneside is one of the top 10 performing local authorities in the country. Chair.
Thank you.
Can you hear the groans already? I think quite rightly North Tyneside is to be commended for having the schools in the top 10% of the country, and I think it's wonderful that 94% of children have been admitted to the first school, the first preference school, and the council should be commended for that. I think what we've heard there is a lot of policy, a lot of statistics, a lot of detail, and I thank you for that answer. What I would say is that for the parents affected by this George Stevenson High School admissions that we've seen this year, this has come as quite a shock. And whilst all the detail and all the statistics may be quite correct, the parents of these children, they're not statistics, they're not details. They want their children to go and have the education that they desire for those kids. One of the other options these parents have is to send their children to Seatonburn, that is within the catchment area. And I don't believe, I may be corrected, that Seatonburn would be classed as one of the schools in the top 10% of schools in the country. So therefore, what we're telling, it's a failing school, it's undergoing transition to academy status. So what we're actually saying to these parents is potentially, you're going to send your children to a school that is deemed as failing, not a school that is successful. So I'd ask, we know that schools are going to be built in the future or whatever, but what are we saying to these parents who are not able to get their children to go to the school that they want and potentially sending them to a failing school?
Thank you for the supplementary, thank you for the positive comments about North Tyneside's performance. just to clarify, is the local authority that's in the top 10% of the country. I'm also sorry that it is a shock to you, and I can understand from one point of view, because pupils previously from Green Hills have gone into George Stevenson High School. However, as I said, we have policies that are in place and procedures and have to consult formally, and it would take at least a year to change anything. But I am well aware of the situation. I am also very sympathetic to the fact, as the mayor is as well, that these are children and it's individuals that we're talking about, not statistics. However, because we have to conform to the rules and regulations set down by the DfE, the only current option for parents in this situation is to appeal, and I would strongly advise all of you to appeal, and it is the independent appeal panel that will listen to the exact case and comment that you have put to me in emails that you put here tonight, and the fact you can highlight the information of how closely you live, what community you're in, and how you are attached to the George Stevenson community area. Unfortunately, that we have to conform with the rules, and because the school has admitted within the criteria to the standard number on the previously agreed and consulted catchment area and PAN numbers, the only option within the legal process, as it were, that we're governed by, unfortunately for your children currently, today and tomorrow, the next few days, is for the appeal. And I do wish you well on that, and I do know that some parents are successful at appeal, and I do wish you well on that. I can assure you that we will continue to keep the situation under review, hence I asked, and also in light of the question, I did ask about the information for year five and destination predictions for those pupils as well. And I also sought information on house building and things like that, so that I can take to my cabinet colleagues any concerns or alarms that we have. But I do absolutely take on board the fact that you're here for your children, and it's very important, and I do accept that. But I'm sorry that the rules that we're sort of ruled by are what I've outlined.
Thank you, Ms. Marshall, do you have a submitted question?
Yes, sir. Thank you very much for the response. It is great to see that the schools in North Tyneside are performing so well ahead of the rest of the country. And I accept that 94% of children did get their first choice for their high school this year. There is a lot of house building going on in North Tyneside, especially in the NE27 and NE12 area, and that is going to continue over the next couple of years with what has already been granted planning permission. So really what I want to know is, for next year, you're saying there is enough space for the children within the area to go to George Stevenson. That hasn't been the case this year. But is there a short-term solution, so if this does happen in the next couple of years again, that George Stevenson can support, and the council and admissions can support, with local children going to their local school? Because my son is going to have to get a bus past George Stevenson to get to the school that he's been offered, when it's 10 minutes walk and 0.581 miles away from my house.
Yes, thank you for the question. Yes, I take on board the comments you're making about planning, and that's why I've had the analysis done, and I will keep abreast of that and continue to monitor and review this situation, and we will keep it under review. The answer that I gave regarding next year's year five, what I said was, on a couple of assumptions, that those who are currently in middle schools continue to go to middle schools, those in primary schools continue to go to primary schools, and those in special schools continue, George Stevenson would not be admitted to its PAN number, its maximum number, 228, from in-catchment pupils with those assumptions. So what I said, I didn't say there was enough places. What I'm saying is that they would not admit to their maximum number, and therefore if there are spaces up to 228, they would then admit on the criteria of those that are nearest from out-of-catchment area.
Mr. Johnson, do you have a supplementary question?
I do. Thank you. Echoing my colleagues next to me, I think North Tyneside is a great place to live. I've lived here 17 years and almost moved to Morpeth about a year and a half ago, but keen to stay in the area. My question was about the Year 5 student count as it stands. And I completely understand the assumptions that have been made. I would have to make the same assumption myself. My request was to get the exact number so I can make my own inference as to whether I'm going to stay in the borough or I'm going to move and do something else. I have the luxury that my child doesn't apply until later on this year. So could I request that I get the exact number as it stands today so I can draw my own logical conclusion? Thank you.
In answer to that, I would have to wait until after the appeal process has been concluded before I share that. However, once the appeal process for this September's admission has been concluded, because we are governed by certain rules regarding information that can be disclosed, and the appeal process has been concluded, I would be willing to share that exact information with you. But I hope you understand why I've got to do what I do, because there is a legal appeal process to be gone through.
Ms. Johnson, do you have a supplementary question?
No.
Okay, thank you. That takes us on to question 8. Is Mr. Abbey in attendance?
Yes, sir. I ask a question in view of the 5% increase in council tax, acknowledging that with the growing ageing population, there will inevitably be strain on the social care resources. I further acknowledge the need for joint strategy for social care with the NHS to free up bed space and resources there, giving the ill and infirmed the most appropriate care they deserve. I therefore acknowledge, as a local council taxpayer, my responsibility to contribute to that. Why, however, on that basis, has the elected mayor rejected the opportunity to have an additional £50,000 in next year's financial year for mental health, as proposed by the Conservative councillors? I, and I am sure other ratepayers, deserve a breakdown of how this increase was decided and the disclosure of what alternative budgets were suggested, and if rejected, on what rationale. The quality of life of residents is a balance of paying the correct amount of local tax and receiving the appropriate amount of services. This includes policing and the precept rise of 2% for 2017 to 2018. Good governance of our finances requires good management and a structured reduce strategy. Therefore, my question simplified to Mrs. Redfern is, what were the proposed alternative budget suggestions and why were they rejected?
Thank you,
Mr. Can I ask Councillor Pickard to respond, please? Thank you, Chair. The procedure for agreeing the Council's budget is that the Mayor and Cabinet present their proposals to the Council. The Council receives the report. There is then a budget setting meeting, and this year was on the 16th of February. At this meeting, members had the opportunity to put forward objections to the Mayor's budget, and if any objections were agreed, they would be further considered by the Mayor and Cabinet and brought back to a subsequent final budget meeting. Objections were received from both the Liberal Democrats and the Conservative Group. The Conservative Group objection was rejected by the Council. The main reasons for that were they had intended not to increase the Council tax by 2%. The Council agreed that this was financially imprudent, as in the local government settlement, the cuts to Council funding from the Conservative Government assumes that Councils do raise the Council tax, and therefore additionally reduce each Council's grant by that equivalent each year. The consequence of this is that in addition to the already significant cut of £50 million over the next 3 years, we have to find an additional £5 million to make up for this shortfall. The £5 million alone would have been a hidden council tax rise of 6% just to cover the one-off nature of the proposals. The council received a one-off dividend from the airport of £2.69 million. The Conservatives chose to use this one-off to reduce council tax and to pay for payments and road improvements. As I previously explained, this would have to be replaced or to raise council tax. But in addition, the council would be left with an extra debt payment of £200,000 a year to pay, and for this, additional £100,000 from revenue, without any indication of how they would maintain this for future years. A further short-term action was to use immediately the £175,000 available from settlement adjustments. This was how they were going to find additional money for dementia daycare. However, it's interesting to note that they proposed to spend more on free parking than on dementia. So in total, they would have reduced our reserves, balances and contingencies by £2.86 million for a one-off expenditure.
The mayor's taken the position that the 2.68 will be held in reserves and contingencies. This was because, as with other councils, we faced tremendous financial pressure on services to vulnerable groups. Many of our expensive services are demand-led. For example, you cannot predict each year how many children will need to be taken into care, how many residents will need extra care partners, and how many residents with learning disabilities will need additional care. At the moment, our learning disability and mental health service now face a pressure of nearly £4 million. So the proposal to use part of the contingencies for dementia care would mean less to support unseen pressures, but more cynically, the rest of the 175,000, i.e. 125,000, will be taken away from our vulnerable groups to give free parking and additional grass cuts. I think this shows where the priorities are. Not surprisingly, this objective was put to the meeting and was defeated by 45 votes to 7. The Liberal Democrats, this was rejected because it consisted of only a critique, asking the mayor to write to the government to complain about the government cuts. But this critique did not include any suggested financial changes other than to ask to review certain areas of expenditure without any indication as to alternative financial proposals. This objection was put to the meeting and was defeated by 49 votes to 2. The council accepted the mayor's proposals for the budget. The reason for this was that the budget proposals had once again risen to the challenge of the further attacks on local government through the relentless government cuts agenda. It continued to protect services such as libraries, the environment, leisure facilities, weekly bin collection, and no charges for garden waste collection. The budget still invests in our communities, in our coastline, our town centres, and continue to be business friendly to attract new employers and jobs, yet still has sufficient reserves and contingencies to cope with any additional demand for service from our most vulnerable residents. We are now running the council on £41 million less than when the Conservatives were in control of the council, or by the end of this financial year, £62 million. With this level of efficiency, it's no wonder the Conservatives accepted all of the Labour Mayor's efficiency measures of £18 million, and then praised what we've done in the last 4 years in achieving service delivery improvements, and at the same time note that resident satisfaction with those services has risen. The Mayor's budget on being put to the meeting was approved by 42 votes for and only 2 votes against. There were 7 abstentions. The 7 abstentions all being Conservative councillors. If you look at the definition of abstain, it is formally declined to vote either for or against a proposal or a motion. So therefore, they did not oppose the mayor's budget. However, I think it was more like the other definition, to restrain oneself from doing or enjoying something. Obviously, they did not want to publicise how enjoyable they found the mayor's budget and how suitable it was for the residents of North Tyneside.
Right, I'm advised it's nearly time up, but I think I'm going to let you come in for a supplement.
Yes, sir. Wouldn't mind. Thank you. Great book. Thank you very much for that detailed response. I was trying to take in all the information, and you may have alluded upon the point that I'm going to ask in a supplementary question. I'm not 100% certain, but in any event, for clarification, I seek clarification on this matter. Council received a dividend of over £2.6 million from its shares in Newcastle Airport. Why was that money not used to pay for services in the next financial year, rather than putting extra burdens on residents by raising council tax again? Or is the dividend needed to bail out the council's finances for this year, because they have been so badly managed that there is a huge overspend, as reported to the financial subcommittee? And if this is indeed what the money was salted away for, why wasn't the mayor open and transparent with residents at the February budget meeting?
Chair, I can understand how you have how the questioner has no idea of local government finance, so that is understandable. However, I did mention that the 2.68 million was actually put into reserves and balances, because each year nobody, unless somebody can tell me how they're going to predict how many children are going to be in care, how many old people with dementia need additional care packages, how many people with physical disabilities need extra care packages, how many people transitioning from children to adult need additional help and support. That's what the money's for. It's the one-off clause that you talk of doing have to be put back into the council's budget. Anytime you use reserves or balances, it has to be financed the following years and put back in. As I said before, this would lead to a black hole of 6% in the budget. If you want to find out where the full details are, they're all available on the council's website. There's also a video of the meeting as it progresses.
Thank you, Councillor. Well, that's the end of the public question time. Thank you as well as a public comment. turn to the next item. We're on to item two, which is a report of this, I received a report of this from councillors Karen Ray, Paul Mearson, Jim Allen, John Walker, Pam Brooks, Morgan Brunels. Is there any other apologies for officers? Councillor Bowen. Good, thank you. And I also welcome the two members of the Youth Council. The group here. I can remember from my members to wear a piece of the attendance sheets. Item 3 is the normal declaration of interest. I remind members that they must verbally declare any interest of nature, interest they have, and fill in the sheets.
Thanks, Jay. I declare interest on agenda item number 7 to the director of Tyneside which is equal to the primary care strategy, also was a tripartite strategy between the clinical commission and the local medical committee, to which I am the North Tyneside practice manager representative. In addition, Tyne Health is also the service manager of North Tyneside Care Plus, which is the new model of care, and under motions, I'm the registered manager of Appleby Surgery and North Shields, and if an amendment goes forward to that motion,
but to also declare the interest in Tyne Health and the local medical position. Thank you, Matt. Any other declarations of interest?
Thank you, Chair. Just in the interest of transparency, I declare an interest in item 6, which is really just a presentation, I believe, by the Director of Public Health, but I am the Director and the Chief Officer of Justice Prince Community Interest Company. And that organisation delivers preventative programmes relating to public health. Thank you.
Okay. Is there any others? Then we'll move on. So item 4, which is the minutes. Can I ask the Council to confirm those minutes of the 16th of February, 19th of January and 7th of February? Thank you. Item 5 is the report of the Independent Enumeration Panel. I'd like Councillor Bruce
Pickard
to introduce this report.
Thank you, Chair. Council is required in the Local Authorities Members Allowances England Regulations 2003 to approve a Members Allowance Scheme each year, having taken advice from the North Tyneside Independent Remuneration Panel. The Independent Remuneration Panel has given consideration to the Members Allowance Scheme for 2017-18 and has made recommendations which are set out in Section 3.7 of the panel's report. But now I'd like to hand over to Mr. John Anderson, who is here to present a brief overview of the report on behalf of the Remuneration Panel, and the recommendations will allow members questions.
Thank you. Are you receiving me?
Yes.
Splendid, I shall continue. Here we are, John Anderson, the Chair of the Independent Remuneration Panel, and I'm here to present the panel's report on the Members' Allowances Scheme for 2017-2018. And 50% of my panel are here with me this evening. Bless me. As you will be aware, the authority is required to approve the Members' Allowance Scheme prior to the commencement of the financial year, and the Council is required to have regard to the views of the Independent Remuneration Panel before agreeing the scheme. The panel has considered the level of basic and special responsibility allowances currently paid to members of this and nearby authorities, and recommends that there be no changes to the current members' allowances scheme in this regard for 2017-2018. The scheme also provides a dependent carers allowances to members who have childcare or other care commitments whilst undertaking approved duties. This is currently paid at the equivalent to an hourly rate of the statutory minimum wage. The panel noted the introduction of the government's national living wage on the 1st of April 2016 for all people aged 25 and over. The panel therefore recommends that the payment of the dependent carers allowance under the Members' Allowances Scheme be amended to reflect the national living wage rather than the minimum wage. The national minimum wage will still apply to those under the age of 25. Therefore, the panel recommends that there be no change to the Members' Allowance Scheme for 2017-2018, with the exception that the dependent carers allowance be paid to eligible members aged 25 and over at the equivalent to the national living wage rather than the minimum wage. Thank you, and I'm jolly happy to take any questions.
My question simply is, if we had a member who was aged 25 or less, would that still mean that they got the minimum wage for the dependent carers allowance? Because his words, age 25 or over, doesn't necessarily mention what would happen if you were 24 or over.
I'll just repeat that the dependent carers allowance be paid to eligible members aged 25 and over at the equivalent to the national living wage rather than the minimum wage, and the answer to your question is yes.
Thank you. Any further questions, Mr. Anderson? Or can I have any more comments, Mr. Anderson?
Thank you.
Councillor Figgler, would you like to move to the motion?
Thank you. I'd like to thank Mr. Anderson for, and his committee for all the work they've actually done. And I would like to formally move the recommendations of the Independent Remuneration Panel as set out in section 3.7 of their report.
Do we have a second for that? Is that okay?
Formally second and reserve the right.
Okay, are there any questions from the members? Okay, I will invite members to speak upon the motion.
Thank you, Chairman. I'd just like to thank the panel for their work and say we are happy to accept the recommendations.
Okay, and next one I come back in, Bruce, are we just supposed to do the vote on this?
We are, so we must in full support of the Conservative.
Okay, all those in favour of the report? Okay, that's unanimous. How many degrees are under? Okay, well, no abstention, thank you, Mario.
Too joyful, isn't it?
Okay, that's it for statement 6, was the presentation of the annual report of the Director of Public Health. Can I invite Wendy Burke to give the presentation, please?
Thank you. Thank you, Chairman, Madam Mayor, elected members and colleagues, for the opportunity to present my first annual report as your Director of Public Health for North Tyneside. The Director of Public Health has a statutory duty to produce a report each year on the health of the population and make recommendations on how it can be improved. This year's report asks the question, how fit are we for our own futures? The report focuses on the health status of the over 50s and thinking about what we need to do to ensure that our residents approach retirement in the best possible health in order to live long, healthy and active lives. This presentation gives a snapshot of what is included in the full report. The report starts by setting straight some of the myths associated with ageing. In particular, the widely held belief that ageing invariably brings with it disability, disease, frailty and loss of independence. While it's true that the prevalence of disease increases as we age decade by decade, the ageing process is not the principal cause of disabling disease in older age. Ageing does result in biological and physiological changes in the body, but the changes are very slow. The reason that disease and disability appear to be related to the ageing process is because we see them occurring more commonly each decade that people live. But this has very little to do with the ageing process and much more to do with the fact that people have lived for another 10 years exposed to risk factors in their lifestyle and their environment, and that is what causes disease. These risks can be reduced at any age, even at the age of 60 or older. The report acknowledges that healthy aging is underpinned by the conditions in which we're born, we grow, we work, we live and age, and the wider set of forces and systems influencing the conditions of our daily lives are important in shaping how we age. And these determine both the physical and mental capabilities that we have at any time. The report identifies a growing population in the borough with an estimated 6% increase by 2030 and the ripple effect of the baby boomers. That is the impact of the large birth cohorts of the 40s, the 50s and the 60s, all of whom are living longer. By 2030, the number of over 65s in the borough is estimated to increase by 35% and the number of over 90s by an alarming 72%. The report celebrates the great news that life expectancy is increasing at all ages, but of course we know that that's not evenly spread across the borough. Men in our least affluent wards live on average 10.5 years less than those residing in our most affluent wards. Sorry, least, I should have said, men in our borough live, sorry, men in our least affluent wards live on average 10.5 years less than those residing in our most affluent wards. For women, the corresponding figure is 9.3 years. And the reason for the gap is that we've got more premature death in our least affluent areas. And we've been able to quantify this. This slide shows how many more deaths there are in our least affluent area compared to our most affluent area of the borough. These numbers bring the reality of inequity to life, reflecting real people whose lives are blighted by dying before their time, many before they reach retirement, never mind old age. Husbands, mothers, grandmothers, brothers, sisters. So while it's great news that overall we're living longer, the report asks, are we adding healthy years to life? Healthy life expectancy is increasing, but it's not keeping pace with the increases in life expectancy. The years lived in good health for men in North Tyneside is now 5 years below the state pension age, and for women it's 3 years below. The importance of this is of considerable priority, because it limits economic activity and the social contributions that people can make and creates further demand for health and social care services. The reason for the slow progress with healthy life expectancy is due to the increasing prevalence of some diseases, conditions and disabilities, many of which are associated with old age, but actually a large proportion are not due to the aging process. Of course, there are some conditions of old age that we really don't know how to prevent. Cataracts, Alzheimer's disease, and deafness. But we do know how to prevent or postpone or reduce the severity of conditions that are the major killers and the major disablers. Cancer, heart disease, stroke, respiratory disease, diabetes, musculoskeletal conditions, depression, and vascular dementia. And the key risk factors for these conditions are well known. There's a small number of them, and they're common to the main diseases and conditions. Smoking, excess alcohol, poor diet, inactivity, obesity, and high blood pressure. Around half our population at age 65 is estimated to have at least two risk factors, and the impact of this is seen in the prevalence of chronic disease. We estimate that half the population of our residents aged 50 are estimated to have one long-term condition, and the number of conditions increase with age. More than 65% of our over 65s are estimated to have two long-term conditions, again with greater prevalence in our least affluent areas. These two quotes from leading and world-renowned experts remind us that disease and disability commonly associated with older age are not caused by the aging process. Lifestyle and behaviour are central to modifying risk factors and become increasingly important as we age. Despite really clear evidence of the benefits, there's still often poor uptake of the health behaviour. And the slide with the facts and figures for North Tyneside, I think, demonstrates that beautifully. Of course, we know behaviour is influenced by a complex relationship between socioeconomic factors and behaviour. Just want to touch on, because the report does focus on the centrality of physical activity in healthy ageing, and particularly the benefits of maintaining functional ability as we age. And the benefits are well known. Hippocrates identified physical activity way back in 400 BC. Physical activity improves physical fitness, social connectedness, it reduces the risk of falls, and it helps people to maintain their independence. But paradoxically, as we age, we become less active. you saw from the previous slide, 50% of our residents aged 65 plus are inactive. And we now know that the age-related changes that we once thought were solely due to ageing are actually due to the result of a disuse of muscles and an inactivity. And the practical importance of this in an older person with insufficient muscle strength means that they find very basic everyday activities like rising from an armchair and getting to the toilet on time impossible. Muscle function is essential for independent and active life. But good news, folks, lost fitness can be regained at any age with physical activity, even in extreme old age, and it doesn't require complex intervention. There are five dimensions to physical activity: strength, stamina, suppleness, and skill, and they're all addressed in the CMO's guidelines for physical activity in adults and older people. And the fifth dimension is healthy weight, and here's why. Obesity increases each decade as we age. The only exception we can see from the graph is women over the age of 85, where the rates fall off. There's simply no biological reason why people should be heavier at 70 than they were at 20. It's not a consequence of aging. Obesity exacerbates the age-related decline in physical function and does lead to frailty. The report also acknowledges that physical health is very closely associated with emotional and mental well-being, and physical health is overwhelmingly a key determinant of happiness amongst over 65-year-olds. The belief persists that depression is synonymous and inevitable with ageing, and actually that is a faulty notion. Depression that first develops in later life is much more likely to bear some relationship to physical health. An older person in good physical health has relatively low risk of depression. The report also has a heavy focus on social and economic factors and identifies a growing body of evidence that our social relationships are critical for us to age well. Studies have found that older people who have close connections and relationships not only live longer, but also cope better with health problems and are much less likely to experience depression. Social inclusion and access to social networks is a known protective factor for health and well-being as we age. But with advancing age, people often lose connections with their networks, particularly those established through work and family, and find it more difficult to initiate new friendships. We've developed a map of the borough that identifies areas where there are greater risks of residents being isolated. This slide summarises the key findings from the report. Older people contribute to society in many ways, whether it be within their family, to their local community, or to society more generally. But the extent of that contribution and the opportunities available to each of us as we age are heavily dependent on health. If people are experiencing these years in good health, their ability to do the things and the things they value will have few limits. But if those years are dominated by decline in physical and mental capability, the implication for older people in society will be much more negative. There is a growing concern about the impact of an ageing population on health and social care costs. But actually, I conclude from my report that the health and social care costs are being driven by a growing population and an increase in the prevalence of chronic disease, and not by ageing per se. The report sets out a number of recommendations and calls for systematic action to promote healthy ageing. This is clearly not the domain of a single agency or an organisation, and it isn't just simply about individual behaviours and choices. Our Health and Wellbeing Board is well placed to provide systems leadership to galvanise action across our partnerships and implement the recommendations of this report. I'll leave you with a final quote that embodies the key messages of the report, and I'd like to take the opportunity to thank the fantastic team of people that has worked with me to produce the report, which will be published on the council website at the end of next week. Thank you all very much for listening.
Thank you, Mr. I invite members to ask questions of clarification arising from the presentation at this stage. Any questions, clarifications? Okay, can I? Sorry, Margaret.
Sorry, have you finished with the questions and clarification?
I just want to. Right, okay, so I was right for the big one. Okay, Graham, you've got a hand up
for clarification? Yeah, it's just on a question. You did mention something about somebody in their 70s, retiring in my 70s now, there's no reason why you shouldn't be the same way as what you were when you were 20s.
Careful what you say.
Well, I don't care what I say, isn't it? Obviously, everybody knows I've got cancer, and I get hormone injections, right? And then hormone injections don't allow me to lose weight. Plus, again, so I drink as well. I don't drink much that now, but I do four to five hour walk every day. I'm on a diet, I eat just over 1,000 calories a day, it's a proper controlled diet. I can't lose weight. Now, you know, this is not a question, but I just want to see it. Every time I see a presentation, I guess I feel as though I've got to apologise for being wrong. Because everybody gets to be more people, right? I mean, in the papers you see all the time, I pay taxes on your pension, your old age pension, every pension I've got. So I contribute to what, everybody says I'm not contributing to. I pay for my mother and father, my kids pay for me, but I also pay as well. So I'm not going to apologise, but I feel as though I've got to all the time. But can you send me a copy of the presentation, because you're flicking through too quick for me to read. And that's an age thing.
Okay, are there any written members to make any comments on Robert?
Thank you. It's the second time I've heard this presentation and it's actually got better. Unfortunately, so many of the messages there I felt were absolutely directed at myself and my lifestyle. But I'm sure that every member, everybody in this room of a certain age could see a relevance of that report to them and their lifestyles. Can I thank our Director of Public Health for what I thought was a very good presentation with just the right amount of humour and seriousness. And I think this report could perhaps go into our wider world in North Tyneside. And I hope to invite, I hope that the Director of Public Health might find it possible to go and give this presentation to the
Thumbria
Healthcare Board.
Thank you, Margaret. Are there any more comments from members?
Chair, I wonder if the speaker is aware that it announced today that within 3 years there'll be a tablet being taken to come to it and just to live much, much longer.
Gary?
Yes, thank you, Chair. When in that presentation, about 65 is a miracle pill. Would I was just wondering if everybody, once everybody reached 65, the council would give them a free swimming pass, a gym pass, and that maybe would cut the cost of social care, maybe cost effective in the long run. Just an idea.
Anthony?
Yeah, just got two comments there. One, I think the presentation hitting people of a certain age, I think that's anybody greater than zero would probably fulfill the presentation. There was a thing of the five strands, which is a very small graphic. It'd be nice to see what that is in a bigger graphic, because I think I need to look at my life a bit.
Okay, is there any further comments? John?
Wendy, one of the key issues or key messages coming through there was around loneliness and isolation, particularly in older people. Do you think there's anything that the council should be doing together with its partners to try and reduce the levels of loneliness and isolation in the borough?
Okay, questions and comments have been mixed up a bit, but Wendy, feel free to answer any if you want to answer at all.
Thank you. I would just make one comment. A lot of people have talked about, you know, that this presentation is never meant to get at individuals. This is about presentation about the population as a whole. And I think my comment about actually this is bigger than just about individual choice. This is about organisations. It's about how society kind of views ageing and the older population. And you know, I take on Councillor Clinton's point around the whole notion of we live in an obesogenic environment in which it's much, much, much easier to be overweight than it is to be a healthy weight. So actually, you know, individuals are not exclusively and solely responsible. They can't be. It's much bigger than that. So, you know, this was not about getting at individuals, it's not about bashing individual people, this is about the whole systems approach. The point that Councillor O'Shea mentioned about should we be doing more about social isolation, we absolutely should, but I think the point is that actually social connectedness and mental well-being and physical health as we get older are all interconnected, and that you can't separate one from the other, because actually if you've got poor physical health and poor mental health, it's likely that you're going to be more socially isolated. So there's something about seeing that in the whole and not just focusing on physical health and lifestyle and thinking about mental health separately. We need to think about it in the round.
Thank you, Chair. I'd like to thank Wendy for her presentation. I too would welcome a copy of the slides. I hope when it goes on the web that the slides will be easy to read, because they do have so much information that it's rather difficult to take it all in. I think it, whilst clearly there are environmental factors and accidents of birth, I'll put it that way, have huge impact on people's lifestyles, I think it does emphasise that we all do have a huge responsibility as well for our own health, and the message of that we're more and less, I think, would apply to everybody, regardless of the situation in which they find themselves. With regard to loneliness, I think also there's a question of responsibility for us as individuals. It does concern me very much that whilst people are living longer and in many ways are better off, and IT and so forth has provided many benefits, I think also the world of IT and virtual lives, whether it's on Facebook or whatever, is improving loneliness for many people. They can communicate with people across the world, Skype, etc., which they couldn't have done just a few years ago, and that's a huge benefit. But a lot of people are isolated, and it's all very well having a plastic screen in front of you. That doesn't provide the benefit of human contact. And really what I'm saying, I think we all as individuals do have responsibility to look out in our own communities. As more councillors, we probably come across people in that situation. And I think that's something we do need to be mindful of.
Okay, if I have a chance, any comments from any members? No? Okay. Wendy, can I thank you very much for coming and educating us on that? Okay. We'll move on to item 7. Which is the response to the council motion on the adoption of the NHS services and implications of the STP in North Tyneside. Can I ask Councillor Hall to move the report?
Yes, thank you, Lynn. In moving this report, can I refer members to the circulated alteration to motion that has come around the chamber? I move the recommendations and then speak to the report. Can I move recommendation 1? 2, 3, and 4.
Okay, before we can take recommendations 3 and 4, I need a definition of the council. Are happy with that?
Great.
Is that agreed? Okay. Can I move
on? Chairman, elected mayor, members of the council, here is a review requested by council on the 19th of January 2017. We were asked to look at the reduction of NHS services in the borough and to consider the outcomes of the sustainability and transformation plan, known as the STP, for the residents of North Tyneside. In October 2014, the NHS set out to create a modern and sustainable organisation. STPs were published in December 2015 to support the implementation of the 5-year forward view. Confusion arose because these plans were not circulated to local authorities for some considerable time. The plan states it will improve quality, develop new models of care, improve health and well-being, and improve efficiency, all at less cost. A number of changes in the last 2 years in the NHS and North Tyneside reflect the priorities described in the STP and have contributed to the improvement in North Tyneside's clinical commissioning group financial position. Urgent and emergency care has caused the greatest confusion. Residents are left unclear as to where to go for minor urgent treatment and what is an accident worthy of a visit to the Thurrock Heath Specialist Emergency Care Hospital. Clearer information is clearly needed for everyone. An announcement of reorganised urgent care centre, an urgent care centre in North Tyneside, is to be made next week. May I just point out that we do need to get back to a 24/7 service for urgent care treatment now. Residents have experienced long waiting times at NSEC. These long waits have caused great distress. Any changes in the STP must alleviate this situation. Confusion about emergency care has not helped here. Maternity care moved to NSEC. While improving this service, many felt that Waverley Hospital was more convenient for patients and visitors in North Tyneside. Financial pressures have resulted in the clinical commissioning group reducing many community services. I'm not going to go through them all, they're listed on page 44 of the report. Whilst all are important, the changes have resulted in less money for mental health services, which are under enormous pressure as demand far exceeds resources. A real cause for concern is the children and young people's mental health services, known as CAMHS. Cuts in these budgets can only do harm. The Health and Wellbeing Board has welcomed the STP focus on intervening early to help prevent illness and disease. Our previous presentation made reference to the need for that. We do not yet have the confidence that there is sufficient attention paid to public health and good health promotion included in this plan. STP footprints were established using patient flows where people travelled for treatments. Northumberland, Tyne and Wear and North Durham forms the STP which relates to our NHS. But there is clearly a split between North Tyneside, Newcastle and Northumberland and the south of the Tyne. The remaining hospital changes will take place south of the Tyne. We are lucky to have three outstanding hospitals serving our residents and they will remain as they are. It would be useful if local authorities in our STP footprint met to consider the impact of the STP changes on local services. I must apologise for all the initials. The STP states that collaboration, not competition, should take place. This changes the present purchaser provider split in the NHS, which has never worked efficiently. This is all in order to make further savings in the NHS. As part of the statutory duties of the Health and Wellbeing Board, we monitor the work of the CCG and the development of the STP. It is felt that not enough information is available for us to have a knowledgeable opinion on these changes. We are aware that the government is using these plans to make further savings in the NHS. I would like to thank everyone on the Health and Wellbeing Board and our partners for their contribution to this excellent report. Thank you.
Yeah, a second for that, Alison.
Thank you, Chair. As Deputy Chair of the Health and Wellbeing Board and lead member for Adult Social Care, I've followed the STP development and NHS changes to services very closely. I'm clear that the link between health and social care is a critical one for our residents, but in particular for those who rely on vital social care services. I've welcomed the STP commitment to care quality, but I'm concerned about recent changes to services set out in the report that have already taken place, such as the withdrawal of funding for the memory support service and social prescribing. Both of these services have brought some of our most vulnerable adults and their carers across the borough, and the reduction in funding precipitated by the financial position of our local CCG has already had a direct impact on the services commissioned by adult social care. Reviewing the current STP plans, which I must comment appears very late on detail and substance, it does not appear to take enough account of the impact on the authority and our ability to deliver social care into the future. I personally cannot find any detailed analysis or evidence to support proposals about shifting resources, capability and capacity towards social care to provide the levels of care required in the community and outside of hospital settings. There is little detail about how the gap in funding will be addressed. This is particularly challenging when the gap in social care funding estimates are included in the figures. In addition, the STP does nothing to tackle neither the living wage nor the rising demand for social care for people with learning disabilities post-winterborne. Indeed, neither will the precept and the supposed extra government funding announced recently in the budget for social care solve the current funding gap. These measures are simple knee-jerk reactions by the Conservative government to address the claims by their own backbenchers and Tory-run councils in recognition, at last, that social care was in crisis because of the stringent cuts experienced by local government since they were elected in 2010. So after crippling social care, the Conservatives turned their eyes on the NHS and come up with STPs. Even a rudimentary glance at the plans for the local STP, one can't help but observe that with projected savings of between an estimated 625 to 904 million, the STP is being driven wholly by the need to take money out of the healthcare system. By closing down hospital facilities, cutting the number of beds available, and by shedding staff. Coincidentally, I believe it will also allow the private sector to take a greater role in providing services within the NHS framework, something which the Conservative Party is ideologically committed to. But it's not all doom and gloom. Like Councillor Hall, I too am pleased to see a focus in the STP on prevention. Supporting our residents to remain as healthy and independent as possible is an important step in managing the demand for current and future social care services. However, we need much more detail about how the CCG will make this happen at a local level. And for these reasons, I think it is imperative that the ongoing implementation of the STP must include local authorities as true partners in the arrangements, and that we are fully engaged and scrutinise proposals for NHS changes, especially when they affect such diverse demographic and large geographical areas, such as the one proposed under the Northumberland, Tyneside and North Durham STP footprint. I believe it is important that local health and wellbeing board chairs and all neighbouring authorities should be discussing the STP proposals. And as a matter of urgency, as elected members, we should be voicing our residents' views and concerns and communicating them on behalf to the highest levels of the NHS and government. And I accept the additions proposed by Councillor Hall. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any questions on the report? Judith?
Thank you, Chairman. I'm wondering why the review didn't consider the new models of care review and the urgent care review which is going on at the moment, which will affect services.
The Health and Wellbeing Board has reviewed and looked at those two areas. They have a special place on our agenda. We could have gone on for ever and ever in this report, listing everything that we look at. Oh, sorry, I've just been prompted. It's the Integration Board that looks at these areas.
Why did the review not look at the assets which are available as well?
I'm not quite sure what is meant by assets.
Well, it
during the debate, Chairman, I did highlight that the assets of the local healthcare trust group, for example, are showing some £25 million in cash at the end of the last financial year. So I'm wondering why that has been considered. That has been considered as part of this review.
Chair, our review was into the STP and the services to the residents of North Tyneside. We did not have a brief to go into the larger finances of the healthcare trust.
But surely, Chairman, if you are looking at services locally, you should look at the health of the equation. You know, if that money is available, why didn't the review ask what the healthcare trust is going to do with it?
Can I just reiterate that what we did was we actually looked at what the motion stated, and took that quite literally, that we were asked to look at the reduction of NHS services in the borough and consider the outcomes of the STP for the residents of North Tyneside, and that's what we did.
But surely, Chairman, it would not be sensible to look at the assets which are available.
Sorry, Chairman. You've got the answer to the question. If you've got anything else, I can come up and take that point. No, okay, is there any other questions from members? Okay, I now throw open to members to speak to the motion. Bruce.
Chair, I had another amendment I wish to move. I've given a copy to the legal.
Okay, I've got a copy of this. Is there any member got a copy of this evening?
No.
Okay. It's on the screen, but I'll wait so everybody says it and reads it before we go any further.
I've been surprised over the last 12 months about the number of residents who are having real problems trying to contact with the National Health Service and trying to understand what's been going on. It appears there's been a gradual erosion of access to services Stoke or Tyneside. I think one of the problems, as was mentioned before, was the move from urgent care and accident care and then the downgrading of the A&E departments. There may have been some publicity at the start, but people really don't understand what's going on until they're then stuck in that situation. Suddenly they find that they move from one hospital to another hospital, they find that they've gone to the wrong area for the issues that they actually have, and I think a lot more could be done to give some further publicity about how this actually system works. I'm also concerned that what was the urgent care has been cut down from a 24-hour service to closing at 12 o'clock at night to 8 o'clock in the morning. And the information given to us on why that has happened is because of lack of resources for the A&E at the Cramlington Hospital. So as a direct result of the underfunding, people in North Tyneside are missing out again. Add that to the confusion they've already got, that when they have worked out where to go, it's closed. They then have to go once again up to the Cramming Hospital. And some of the stories, and they're not all stories, I've actually witnessed some of them myself, who have been having relatives been ill recently, of 5 hour waits in the A&E, of people lying there in agony in a recovery position, of other people being sick into receptacles around the area. And if some people actually just given up and going, oh, that has to be dangerous, that has to be bad for the results we're going into. So I think that we're asking for the reinstatement of the 24-hour care in the borough, but also asking to reconsider the reduction from 3 urgent care centres down to 1. The urgent care centres do a good job when the doctor's services are no longer there, and they actually filter out quite a lot of the accident stuff that could perhaps be dealt with at a lower level and have to then go to the emergency exit at the Cramming Hospital or even up to the RVI. And it's not minor issues. Some people, you know, it may not be life-threatening, but it can still be painful and uncomfortable to an individual. And these give very good service, I've used a few of them, saying very good service to the borough, people of the borough, able to alleviate that pain and help them until they can actually get through, say, the weekend or through the next day, to actually see a doctor. We also have the issue of the SDP, perhaps turning into a cost-cutting exercise, but my issue is the fact that it's not doing anything to look at prevention of tackling inequalities in health. We've just had a very good presentation from the Director of Public Health, which shows in areas in this borough, for men, as it was said there, was 10.5 years less life expectancy because of the area they're living in the borough. Perhaps that presentation would also be given to certain sections of the council when considering applications for other areas that might add to that environment, as we're told by the Director of Public Health. Countries directly to that particular area. But it's not just the fact that it's not tackling that, it's also practical experience at the moment says there's a further exclusion, and that's an exclusion of access. Now I accept that the parts of Isborough where it's very easy to get to and more convenient to get to Cramming than it is down to the hospital that was at Ridley in North Tyneside. However, if you are from the Riverside Ward or from the bottom end of North Shields or from the bottom end of Wall's End and have no personal contact or access to a car, it's very difficult, particularly if you're elderly, to actually maintain a link with a relative that is actually in hospital. We have situations where people in their 80s are going to one partner to the RVI, another partner to the Cramlington. The one who goes to the RVI is then referred to Sheffield, then to Liverpool. The one that goes to Cramlington is then referred, when they're discharged, is then referred back to the doctor who says, I can't do anything, refers you to the Freeman, who then refers you back to the doctor who refers you to the RVI, who then do so. And that person, who may have memory issues, is having to recount this issue 6 times until something actually happens to that individual. This can't be fair on the people of North Tyneside. And I believe that experts are good at the expert advice they give, but they don't know about all the issues concerned with access to these places. If you follow the experts' advice, we'd have one hospital somewhere in the country which would be super efficient, but actually hope is going to get to and to actually get your help and seen to. Therefore, these amendments as a further recommendation just seek to try to readdress the issues that are seriously concerning the residents of North Tyneside, and hope the council will accept them.
Do we have a second?
Yes, Chair, I'd like to second that. Others, I'm really pleased to be able to second this because one of my main concerns around the current plans for the NHS was the fact that the CCG are currently procuring one site that will replace the 3 existing sites called the urgent care. Somebody who's used Battle Hill, I know personally how good that site is and it will be missed. What this is actually suggesting is that by closing these sites, we're going to make a lot harder, as many people have already pointed out, for vulnerable people to access the care they need. And this will actually result in more people in A&E, will result in more people going to A&E, increasing the waiting times, which suggests to me that the STP's main focus is cuts, not care. As we all know, social care is hugely underfunded, and whilst the announcement of extra money for social care is welcome, the fact is, it's sprung out over 3 years and there's very little to compensate for the savage cuts that we've had to endure in social care. Now, just to put this in, a guy called James Bloodworth was writing for the International Business
times, and he described the effects of cuts to social care and cuts to community NHS facilities very simply, stating that when rural people lack adequate social and local healthcare facilities, they are more likely to turn up at the overstretched hospitals and NHS departments, thus increasing the burden on the NHS. The result, this to him means that any reductions in social care and community NHS facilities will increase the burden on the NHS. Now, that's a very simple way of putting it. However, it seems that this one simple fact has lost on many people in the government. I mean, incidentally, Mr. Bloodworth goes on to argue a correlation between the current crisis and privatisation of social care that started in 1979. However, I digress, and that might be an aspect for another day. What is apparent of this is that this crisis hasn't come out of nowhere. The crisis it's not come out of nowhere. It has been on the lines for a long time. Whilst the NHS has been strong leadership, it is fact that Mr. Hunt has acted more like a hermit in the cave, blind to the world around him. Or perhaps probably the best analogy I can come up with is Mr. Hunt is more like Nero playing his fiddle while the wrong bird. That's the truth of what the NHS seems to be in at the moment. However, we should also remember that he also co-authored a book that called for the NHS to be privatised, so maybe he's not as oblivious to the current crisis as he tries to make out. And anyway, I think logic here is simple. We have to defend the national assets. We have to defend our residents' right to access these healthcare, and therefore I urge everybody to accept the amendments and accept the recommendations of this side. Thank you.
Any questions? No, then we'll go straight to the debate. Does anyone want to make a comment on the amendment? Judith?
I do agree that further publicity is needed for residents to explain where the appropriate care is available as regards to any hospital support. I think the rest of the recommendation is premature. A lot of work is already being done in addition to the diligent care review and the new model of care as well, and that has to be taken into account here. And I think also that the bigger picture is needed after considering those two reviews. I think also we need to bear in mind that the government is providing an extra £1.2 million locally to provide GPs to provide 7 days a week to cover 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. appointments for patients, to get additional money per head to do that. That's coming in, that's much to be welcomed. It is already in action in Gateshead following pilot projects there. And I think that's to be welcomed here. And a lot of collaborative work is being done across the GP practices too. So I think that this recommendation is premature.
Thank you. Judith, Leslie?
Thank you, Chair. Regarding the changes to the centres for urgent care, clearly when this decision was made, we were given lots of information about people's confusion about what does urgent care mean, and some places were called a walk-in centre, some were ENA urgent care, and the view was that none of us were sensible enough to work it out where we needed to go, when clearly it was all about having to save money because of the cuts to the CCG, that they were suffering and the pressures on their services. What we do know, however, is that Battle Hill Walk-in Centre currently sees in excess of 37,000 people a year in the walk-in centre. That is actually more than Ripley and the new A&E hospital put together. It is also cheaper per head or per patient that they see. So it's actually a very cost-effective system. The location of it is also very useful because in the Walls End area, I understand, over 53% of people don't have access to public to private transport or a car. They rely on public transport. And really, do you want to go to any where you should normally be arriving in with a blue light if your child's fell and badly cut its leg, or you're a bit concerned that they might have broken a bone, but they're not in too serious a condition? Is it good to add to that queue in the A&E when people are suffering coronary arrest, potential strokes, etc., really life and death situations? We were told that the consultation was very thorough. It had been validated by our external bodies, and that, you know, people did think that reclaim was the best place to have it, particularly because it could accommodate 24-hour service. And then what happened is a couple of months later, they say it's going to be temporarily reduced and the 24-hour urgent care disappears. Unfortunately, if your child's having an asthma attack, it's quite often in the middle of the night, and that reclaim would have been the ideal place to get them too quickly. So I do think it's really important that, for all the reasons outlined in the amendment, that it is considered. The feedback from the report by Health Watch actually said that their chosen place to go for many people in the southwest of the borough and in the deprived areas of Churton and Riverside, because they felt they were treated with respect and dignity, was Battleham Walking Centre, a place that they didn't feel they were treated with such dignity elsewhere. So I think it's a good recommendation. I could add to the bit about writing to the minister, but I'll save that for the main debate. But I do think that's also essential in view of the rules that's in the SPP itself. Thank you.
Marion?
Thanks, Chair. I'll be supporting this amendment. Like a lot of residents in North End, the contact to me, I think a lot of people are concerned that there isn't 24-hour urgent care in the borough at the moment. And recently I heard on that there was a representative from CCG speaking on the media to say that they didn't think there was a problem with the fact that they're taking away 24-hour urgent care temporarily. But I think one of the reasons why I have to wait so long when it goes to NSEC, and why the RBI now has an increasing using their facilities, is because they have taken away this 24-hour urgent care. I'm afraid illness and having accidents doesn't just happen between 9 and 5. It very often happens a 9 to social hours. And I think we desperately need to have 24-hour urgent care in this borough, and we should be insisting that we do that. I accept the big difference is what different residents see as what is urgent care. That's just happens to be like. We have to learn how to live with that, but I still think that we need this urgent care and that we need to be fighting for it. And the other recommendations are also going on with anybody. Thank you.
Muriel?
I think, right. Thank you, Chair. I think the very first thing that we need to do as a council is to congratulate the staff of all of the hospitals that we have within the area for the work that they have carried out over this winter. In particular, when they've had an enormous amount of pressure, and where there has been the difficulty of misunderstanding of where patients should be taken to, and we've heard about some of the issues and some of the situations that have arisen. And it is only a couple of years since the hospital was opened, but in fact, this hospital is one of the leading hospitals in the area in terms of the type of work that they do, and because of the work and the way that they are staffed, the one in Cramlington, actually is saving lives, because it means that they've got all of the consultants in one place 24 hours and get people there, and the time factor in saving lives is really crucial. So I think we should congratulate them on, and also on the fact simple things like they've now taken on all of the 68 nursing apprentices that they started a couple of years ago, because we are talking about trying to increase the number of apprentices, and they are undertaking that as well. There is work going on at the moment with regard to the ambulance service and discussions with the ambulance service about the 111 service and about prioritising and about understanding where the emergency ambulances should go, because there was misunderstanding. The urgent care centre, particularly at Great Lane and Wansbeck, did plaster people's legs at 9:30 at night, but people thought if you broke your leg, you had to go to Cramlington.
there was a misunderstanding. And it is often when change takes place a long time before people get that into their minds as to where they have to go to. And there have been changes in different sorts of services where you've gone for something maybe to the RBI for a long time and you're suddenly changed to another hospital. So there are a lot of things that are changing. But the thing that does get me about this is all that's being masked at the moment is the underfunding of the National Health Service. The SDP has been thrown up for people to look at, and basically what it's saying is that there are going to be cuts in the budget, and that really has to be directed directly at the government. And how you organise that money from the CCG at the end of the day is very difficult. They were £19 million overspent last year. And you know that now we're getting the social care money coming through. And there are questions about how we spend that social care money, because there are two things we should be doing with the social care money, and it's about addressing this issue of inequalities and prevention. And prevention is the one thing that actually keeps people out of hospital and out of the long-term care. And if we can do more with this social care money preventing people from going into hospital, we will stop a lot of the difficulties that are actually being experienced. And then to address the inequalities, I think that's absolutely right. There's nothing in there that says that tackling inequalities. It is very much part of our health and well-being strategy in the borough. But we are working, we have to work with the local public services in the borough. We are working closely, we have to work closely with the hospital, and we should be talking to them about how this social care money can actually keep people out of their hospital. You know, if you can keep people out of hospital, you're saving money. So this money should be put, this social care money should be put to, and we've always said that keeping people in their own homes is always a more expensive option than putting them into care homes. And we have to keep many more people in their own homes as long as we possibly can. So whilst I support this, I think there are answers, and there will be answers to some of these. There is a review of the 24-hour urgent care and what impact it's had on the hospital in Cramington. That should be completed this next week. The 3 centres to the 1 centre, that should actually be there. So also will the review of the ambulance service and the 111 and where people should actually go to. We yes, publicity as much as we possibly can, because it's no good people going up to Cramington to wait for 4 hours when they could get treated down at Drake Lane or at Wandsbeck or at Hexham. So those things have to be noted. But under all of this, it's about how the National Health Service and social care is funded, and there just isn't enough money to do what we should be doing. Thank you, Chair.
Any further speakers?
Chairman, a lot of very interesting points have come up in this debate. The thing that strikes me is, for me to make a sensible decision on this, I need access to health professionals. I think we're getting ready to give a lot of apparent truth. I'd like to hear people who are really knowledgeable about the health service talk to us about this, so I can take a sensible decision. I don't think I can.
Tom?
First of all, I'll be supporting this, and I particularly like the third part where we're talking to colleagues across the area, the geographical area, which covers 6 councils and a part of the 7th council, quite a huge area. I know that there's a lot of health professionals who are quite concerned about this.
Are you talking about the amendment here, or are you talking about the original motion?
Talking about the amendment? No. Oh, I'm talking about the motion. Oh, sorry.
You're getting that sense,
Tom. It's like you said, it's an EHC.
Okay, is any further? Well, Margaret, you've got the right to reply on this amendment. Answer?
Thank you, Chair. I think what we heard with regard to the urgent care scheme, the misinformation. The health care's own website is transforming emergency care and opening the men's centre in June 2015. Overnight activity at the urgent care centres has been minimal, with on average less than 10 overnight attendances a day across all three urgent care centres. So that's between midnight and 8 a.m. The Trust saw an average of 2 attendances at Hexham, 4 attendances at Brunswick General, and 4 at North Tyneside Red Lane Hospital. And it's also recorded a very high number of days, 83 or more, where there have been no overnight attendances at all between midnight and 8 a.m. at Hexham. And at North Tyneside, there were 12 days with no overnight attendances, and Brunswick General, 19 days with no overnight attendances. In light of the extremely low numbers, this is why the Trust is working with urgent care nursing staff to ensure their skills can be put to best use to meet demand across the Trust. And as I say, I think there is a certain amount of misinformation. Obviously, it's right to review something when the attendances are that low.
Could I just ask a point of order and clarification, please? Somebody having declared an inverse, should this seek to influence the debate? I watched the computer being passed along with the information from a person that declared an inverse and was then read out by another member. To me, that's interfering in the debate after you declared an inverse.
Whether or not the interest is such that it is a use of a member concern should have left them, there seems to be no indication that they should have left them, that there's no reason why they can't participate further in the decision.
Okay, Wendy?
I believe the numbers are so low at Rakeley, North Hexham and Wandsbeck, because when you do get there, there's no doctor to see to you in the sent on to North NSAID, and that's your personal experience. When you get to North Tyneside, ask to see a doctor, there isn't one on site.
Okay, is any fellow members? Mama?
I would just like to comment that we're not here to defend anyone. We're here to fight on behalf of the residents of North Tyneside. They are the people who are raising this concern. They are the people who put us into this position, and it would be ill-advised if we didn't take on their concerns and fight for what they require on North Tyneside.
Sandra?
Thank you, Chair. Leading on from the Mayor's comments, anyone who attended the STP consultation event, which was held in Whitley Bay Customer First Centre on the 16th of January, will be under no illusion of how the public felt. Mm-hmm. Residents were hugely angry and outraged at the plans to put £641 million from the budget, and they are cuts. It's not closing a financial gap, they are cuts. And the messengers were well and truly shocked about the messages that they were giving. And it is down to us to raise these matters, because we see today that the three urgent care centres are going to be closed for a further 3 months till during the night until June. And we're here to help deliver a better service for our residents and not about closing shortfalls or gaps.
And your members wish to speak for motion, Gary?
Just about the restored the 24-hour urgent care. It reminds me very much of a similar situation we had when we had the maternity services at North Tyneside General Hospital. We ruled over on that one, we let them get away with that one, they took away our maternity unit, it's our cramp, I believe, or the RBI, because we're told there was no consultants there, there's only a midwife-led unit, and now it's closed. So I don't know if the Conservative Party are saying they're quite happy for a 24-hour urgent care to leave the borough and go somewhere else, but we know on this side we'll be fighting to keep it.
Anybody else wish to speak for the amendment?
Chair Morgan, you have the right to reply.
Thank you, Chair. Can I say that I agree with this amendment, and I suggest that we request that further publicity and that we restore the 24-hour urgent care as soon as possible. As I said in my presentation, that the decision is being made by CCG next week. I also think that to ask to reconsider the reduction from the 3 centres to 1 is a perfectly sensible request, and that we should do it on behalf of the residents of North Tyneside.
Thank you. Okay, we're going to the vote. All those in favour of the amendment? Those against? Any abstentions? Four in favour, 40 in favour, 3 against, and 2 abstentions. So the amendment now becomes the motion. So we'll now talk about the motion, and it's open to debate again. Anybody wish to speak on the motion?
Tommy. I'm pleased to support this motion. You forget what I said before. And my main reason is because even though we're talking about North Tyneside, this actual STP covers this huge geographical area and has consequences across this area which can in actual fact affect North Tyneside. The interesting thing is that the government would have you believe that this is about improving health provision. Well, in one sense, I suppose you could give them a 5% there on that, but as a resident put it to me, he said it's a bit like the Star Trek project. He says, it only goes where no man has gone before, like Star Trek, don't assume that it will get it right. And that really concerned me. There have been many meetings all over the area to clarify what the STP means. This includes a voluminous document, a summary of this document, and a question and answer document in case you cannot handle the jargon or assimilate the many graphs and charts which a layperson may just find incomprehensible. To put it mildly, it's as clear as mud. The principal design is to save money. As one person said to me, we're here where we are now because of political choices. One of those choices being was to spend 2.5 percentage points of our GDP on health less than the compatible European countries. Now, I think that really says it all. You know, we've been cutting the health service short for years, and let's go along and cut it some more. When I started off, I said some of the things that may affect this borough. And it's interesting because we talk about the urgent care being shut. You know, well, we aren't the only ones. Some of the things that are actually happening, for example, is there's a delay in the new hospital at Berwick, right? Which may seem far away, but you never know the way things is going. Berwick might be the hospital we have to go to. There's a closure of Shotley Bridge and Rothbury Hospital inpatient wards. There's a restriction on urgent care centre hospital services at Hexham, Wandsbeck and Raytheon. There's the North Tyneside 3 walk-in centres being reduced to 1. Mental health services cut by 6 million in 2017 across Northumberland and Tyneside NHS Foundation. You know, I mean, these are just a few of the things that are happening. I think we are right to be concerned, to be perfectly honest, and I think the residents need to have information. It needs to be transparent, it needs to be in plain English so that people can understand. And if you think about the walk-in centres, the walk-in centres are a good example of a disaster in PR. People don't know what they're there for, they don't know where they are, and if they were publicised properly, I'm sure they would be running at full capacity, probably more than capacity, and would be worrying about if we had enough staff to actually staff them. Thank you very much.
Rosalind.
Thank you, Chair. We're very lucky in North Tyneside. We have three outstanding hospitals of Foundation Trust who serve the people of North Tyneside. So we should be in good hands. However, the lack of funding that runs alongside the STP is a disaster in the making. If we look at page 18 of the report, 1.5.12, the CCG was not able to meet the Paralever STEAM test in 2016-17 for mental health spending. The Director of Public Health has talked about the importance of support for people with mental health to socialise, as well as the medical provision that they receive and support. We've seen service, we've seen funding cut from mental health services and continuing to be cut, including 75,000, not a massive amount, from the memory service. Thank God for the lottery that some of our partners in the voluntary sector are managing to pull money out of that, which might help make the patchwork quilt come together. Otherwise, our carers, of people with dementia and Alzheimer's, would be in a pretty bad way. It's also already been referred to children and young people's mental health. We know that people who have mental health at a young age are very likely to continue to suffer it for the rest of their life, and all the knock-on effects it has for employment and other health issues that run alongside of it. Too often there are associated alcohol problems and abuse problems that run alongside mental health. So cuts in service affect that. We have intermediate care where the funding for the CEDARS was withdrawn. Understandably, that was used 95% by the Foundation Trust. And we do understand that that building was old, but it provided fantastic support to get people home. And yes, we now have Ward 23 in Rake Lane providing intermediate care. But I'm not quite sure how that saves money when it's staffed by nurses, much higher paid staff. So I can't see that providing the savings that we're looking for. The referral management scheme that is on page 17 has been successful, it says, in reducing variation in the quality of numbers of the referrals, reducing costs and waiting times for outpatient appointments. Well, as someone who was referred for an outpatient appointment in November, that one disappeared for 4 months. Then eventually got another referral, which resulted in an appointment 3 weeks ago, but which was followed by a letter last week saying that appointment had been cancelled without any reason given, other than to go back to your referrer. Whilst I can see how that is saving costs, because obviously the longer they keep me waiting for an appointment, the less money they're spending. It's certainly not reducing waiting times for patients. One of the big gaps in this, of course, is the lack of funding for prevention. And at the last health and wellbeing meeting when we discussed this, I raised the matter that the savings required in North Tyneside, we were told over a year ago, were 141 million. And a year ago they said they'd managed to identify £4 million worth of savings, a gap left of 137 million. So I asked at the last health and wellbeing board this month, had any progress been made on the 137 million gap? No one could give me an answer for that, even though the SGP members and directors were there. So the money's not there. It's good to have a plan. We would like to be sustainable. We would like to transform services with partners. However, the lack of funding has set this plan up to fail, and that's why I think it is essential that the Mayor writes to the Department of Health and the Minister NHS England, I should say, to raise our concerns. Because I've already seen today someone on Facebook blaming North Tyneside Council because radio's not open 24 hours. But I haven't got that magic wand, and I don't think any of us have. But I think it's essential that we do raise this and keep raising it and keep telling our people what is happening and what impact it's going to have. Because then they might understand why we've had to raise the council tax by 5% to ensure we can continue the care for our disabled people, our people who need adult social care support. Thank you.
Steve?
Thank you, Chair. It's just a couple of points I'd just like to make. It's regards to the Conservatives, every time I hear them around health, they're always saying that they're putting extra funding in, but they're also expecting huge cuts or savings or efficiency gains or whatever they want to call it. We're basically taking out a great deal more money than they're actually putting in. And I seem to recall that the talk we organised the NHS about 2010, which was talking about billions of pounds spent on getting rid of the PCTs and the invention of the CCGs and the various other trusts and bodies and all sorts of reorganisations. And they just seem to be, every time you listen to them, they're blaming somebody else. It's the wait times are too long because the ambulance service isn't quick enough or efficient enough. The people aren't getting out of hospitals because of the social care requirements through local authorities or whatever. It's always somebody else, but they've been there since 2010, and every time things are just getting worse and worse, there's less and less of the targets being met, and they just, time after time, they just say it's somebody else's fault, and they're just basically letting everybody down. And I think this idea that the walk-in centre, the emergency care, closes at 12. In reality, given waiting times, which I'm not saying Mary Glindon's missing its waiting times or whatever, but allowing for waiting times, it basically means if you're not there by about sort of half past seven, you're not going to get seen by the time it shuts at 12 o'clock. It's, so I think a lot of people are either trying to get up to Cramlington or whatever, but the fact that it closes at 12 means it's very difficult for people to get seen. I've had residents and friends personally who've gone at 9 o'clock and been told it's not worth waiting, you might as well go straight to Cramlington now. And that just means it isn't in reality shutting at 12, it's shutting a lot earlier than that. So it's just, I just find that I just kind of rely on the fact that they're going to continue this work today. Thanks very much, Jim.
Joanne Harrison?
Thanks, Jeff. I do think our health service, certainly in the north, is in crisis. And I take the point of the mayor, whereas our responsibility as councillors and a council is certainly to fight for the best services that we can for the people that we represent. So therefore, I look purely simply at the statistics, and the statistics tell me there is a need for more money to actually go into our health and our care. Now, why do I say that? Just see the presentation, which tells me the reason why and that demographics of our northeast. You know, we know in the northeast that we have one of the highest unemployment. We know for a fact we have lower wages. We know for a fact we have poorer health, and we know for a fact there's a bigger demand on our resources in our area with the people requiring those health services. And yet we're moving to an SDP, which we're primarily looking at is, how can we cut and reduce those services? Well, there's only so far that we can actually go when we look at services to about cut them without coming down to the reality of why we need to be investing more in that. And that isn't, you know, shamefully saying that we're squandering or wasting money. It's actually about meeting those needs and demands of those people that we represent, certainly in the Northeast. So just taking around with that SDP and just thinking it's business as usual doesn't actually do it. Because our statistics tell us over the next 5 years, we know we will have more people growing older, we know the demand on the systems will be greater, and we know for a fact that the social care element will actually represent, I think, about 20% of that bill will actually be on the increase. So why shouldn't we be saying we need more money put into our health service? I ain't got the skills and I certainly haven't got the knowledge like some of our colleagues here of telling me the impact on the various hospitals in our area. But what I do know is this. I do know, and I use the statistics quite clearly on this, that the healthy life expectancy of a male in North Tyneside or in our area, you know, 59, and the life expectancy is 78. So therefore, if their healthy life expectancy is taking them just below retirement age, and remember what retirement age is moved to now, we're expecting that person to be under ill health for that period of time. Now what does that mean to us? And it's a similar statistic, certainly for women. It's not just men, it's women also, who, if you think about it, who actually contribute to the economy of the Northeast. And the economy of the Northeast, bear in mind, we're talking about how we need up our game, how the competition that we have, and we're moving to that, are we in that Brexit situation? So we need to get that right, don't we? We need to make sure that we have people who are actually healthy and actually can actually get into that employment. But first of all, my statistics tell me during that period of time, I could probably see more ill health and people are actually contributing to that economy. So just simply for an economy basis, it would seem sensible for me to do that. Then I look at another piece of statistics. You know, a baby boy born, you know, in our area, is expected to live 11.3 fewer years than a child born in Richmond. A young girl, a young baby girl born, is expected to live 11.6 fewer years in good health than somebody born in Wokingham. And those statistics are really something that I am appalled at. And we need to be doing something about that. Yes, we can have our joined up care. Yes, we can go for all our jobs. But the reality is we are needing more investment into our health services and our health care in our area. If we are going to ensure not only we meet our ambitions regarding our economy, but also if we ensure that our people live a healthy lifestyle, our people actually have a better service or a good quality service which they demand. Now I take it as my responsibility to do that. And the way I feel about it at the present moment is we need to be saying to our SDP, making that case why we need more money put into our health service, not just about tinkering around at the edges. Tinkering around at the edges will not resolve the issue of somebody's life expectancy, will not resolve the issue of the impact of our economy, and will not resolve the issue of somebody who may not be living a full and proper life as it would be with someone else in the other part of this country. This is about fairness, this is about equality. We've got to ensure we have that, and it's our responsibility to fight for it in the North East.
Thank you, Chairman. There are two three issues which have been raised which I would like to address first of all. Members opposite are often critical of reviews and maintain that it's simply a way of saving money. Yet the report itself refers to the decommissioning of ineffective services, in this case particularly with regard to heart failure and those in likelihood of falling. So it is clear that reviews do need to be made and do bring a positive benefit. Secondly, comment was made with regard to maternity services moving away from Raytheon Hospital. And I think Councillor Bell has misunderstood that. The level of maternity services, the demand for maternity services in North Tyneside had fallen. And under modern standards of obstetrics and gynecological care, consultants need a particular level of deliveries. They need to be able to assist with a number of deliveries in order to maintain their proper professional expertise, their proper professional qualifications, and their insurance. Because there was an insufficient level of demand, insufficient number of births in North Tyneside, it was not possible to maintain a consultant service safely, one which would enable consultants to come knowing that they could move to other hospitals because their career development, their experience was adequate. If you don't have the number of deliveries, your experience is inadequate, and that would make them unsafe to practice. So that was a professional decision with that one. Thirdly, I'm rather surprised to hear from Councillor Mulvenna the criticism of walking centres, given that they were introduced by Labour. I think it was Lord Darcy that introduced them. Turning to the report itself, I think that this only covers half the picture, half the equation with regard to local services. We did highlight in the debate back in January two particular issues. One was that there were a number of high salaries which had received substantial further increases. Salary packages of around 200,000, I recall, a quarter of a million, which had been increased by around 25%. I think that the review ought to have looked at that to decide whether that was appropriate, whether it was a good use of NHS money. We know that NHS funding is at record levels at the moment. The Conservative government has put record levels of money into our NHS and has pledged more, and the number of nurses and doctors are also at record levels. You could only sustain that sort of expenditure, and we all want the NHS to prosper for the benefit of our residents. You could only sustain that level of expenditure, Chairman, if you have a good, solid economy, and that is provided by a Conservative government. Sadly, the economy is always mismanaged by Labour. That means that we cannot provide good services. That's the sad truth. Councillor Harrison again has referred to employment, and again I remind this chamber that the Labour Party always needs more unemployment than it inherits. Always. A sure sign of disastrous management of the economy. The other matter with that which I'd like to highlight with regard to the report, and again this is something we mentioned in the debate in January, is that there are significant sums available locally. Northumbria Healthcare Trust Group has cash assets of around £25 million. I've mentioned that in my questions, and I think it's very unfortunate that no effort was made in this review to look into that. How has that money been accumulated? Where's it come from? Are other aspects of health services being overcharged? Is money being misallocated? I think that that should have been looked at. I think also they should have been asked what they're intending to do with that money. I don't know whether the Health and Wellbeing Board has inquired into that, but I would suggest that they should. The report should look at that and see what it is intended to do with that money. £25 million sitting locally is a lot of money, and that should have been looked at. This report is really incomplete. Thank you.
Gary?
Yeah, thank you. I'm getting used to getting told off by you at the meeting. But I agree with you on one point, two. I agree on two items, which I was going to mention, Chair, is the reserves, which I think we've heard before. I don't think they've been looked into properly. I think there's reserves lying there. I don't know what to do with them. Are they accumulating them? Are they going to spend them? And also, there's assets as well. There's land. Now, I know that the Treasury and the NHS are speaking to each other at the moment. The NHS can release land, want to release land, but the only trouble is, depending on the case, the money is taken from the Treasury pot. They want the money to come back locally, so they can release land, build houses, make money, bring that into the NHS, which seems a good idea to me. The review didn't particularly look at that very much. The salaries again, there's some humongous salaries in the public sector for NHS, and I think the issue should be looked at as well. But at the end of the day, the NHS agreed for a reason with the government to save £22 billion by 2020. That was their target. And for doing that, the government said they would give them £10 billion by 2020. I think at the moment, the government estimates have released about £4.2 billion, and the NHS has saved about £6 billion. The estimates can be varied, but that's the contract that entered into each other. And they find it very hard, as was on the Andrew Neil's show on Sunday if you watched it. The SDP locally is a cost saving exercise of about £660,000 to £900,000 over this period. The question, I've read the document, I'm on the health, adult social care screening committee. We were at the meeting in January with the Health and Wellbeing Board. The document is a brilliant document. If you look through it, good luck here. But there's nothing on there. How many beds, how many wards, how many staff, hospitals going to close, especially for Pacific for North Tyneside. There's nothing on that. The only way you're going to save money on that vast field is by wards, hospitals, staff, etc. And really, it is a poor show. It's a costume exercise. We, as a Labour Party, and the Liberals vote as well, we've got to fight this, we've got to stand back on that, and we've got to say it's not good for the residents of North Tyneside. Thank you.
John Stern?
I'll be very brief. Once again, you've got the party that's just taking the vote and lying. Really, we'll come here to consider the welfare of the people of North Tyneside. And I think it's everybody, through any programme you watch on the television or anything, he says there's a lot of funding in the NHS. And they think, you know, there should be more waiting times are getting longer, it's taking longer for people to get operations and everything. So I think everybody's sort of agreeing on this. But what really gets me is when I was here when the first chronic in hospital, the extra care unit in chronic was suggested and was told it was going to be in chronic, or the opposite, vehemently fought for it to go to Ring Lane. Now they're talking about 180% turn and actually couldn't service the Ring Lane. It's hypocrisy. Thank you very much.
Martin?
Thank you, Chair. First of all, I just want to say, look, I don't think Councillor Wallace has been peddling that same old lie about the economy in the last Labour government. I don't know if you're aware of this, it was a world financial crisis, not caused by the Labour Party, caused by bankers and their greed. So let's get that lie out of there right now. Not unless she's trying to say that the Labour Party is responsible for the entire world's economic system collapsing. I'm pretty sure she's not stupid to say something like that. And we'll see, because I'm sick of those lies. Now, if I can actually bring it back to the motion that we've got here, because, and I will be quick, because this is what I actually wanted to say, not going to stuff about the economy. What I wanted to say, right, is we've got a very big report here, a very big report with lots of information, lots of speakers, who all like to get various points across. However, I just want to summarise what I think is the feeling in this room at the moment, okay? The feeling I've got is that people on this side, and I will give me way for our colleagues of the Liberal Democrats who have indicated that they will vote in favour of this motion, is that we are in favour of protecting the NHS and the services it provides for our residents. We are in favour of keeping 24-hour urgent care in this borough, and we are in favour of keeping the three walk-in centres in our borough for our residents who need them. The party opposite is interested in defending government cuts to the NHS. They are in favour of removing 24-hour urgent care in this borough, and they are in favour of reducing the walk-in centres to our residents. They are in favour of the reductions to the NHS. That is quite simply, with all the hot air is going out the room, that is essentially what is involved. That's it.
Everyone's already said what I was going to say. Other than what I said the last time we debated this was that we are here to represent the residents of North Tyneside, not to represent the separate government in North Tyneside. To the party opposite, I would say that there is absolutely no room for you to abstain on this tonight. You are allowed to support the report and back the work that's going to be done, going to be done to represent the residents of North Tyneside when you have to vote against it. You can't take the power we have and abstain.
Okay, does anybody wish to speak on this motion regarding removal of that room?
Can I just say at the end, get a call from the board, please?
The camera,
I'm just a bit aghast, I think, that members opposite will vote against it, because I know that they voted consistently and campaigned consistently against the new hospital in Hamilton. There are two things in this. I just want a couple of points. We spend less of our GDP on health than any of the most appealing European countries. And to be honest with you, people don't really want to spend a lot of time in hospital than they actually have to. So one of the things about prevention, which is not mentioned in the SDP, is really important. And the issue about inequalities has not been addressed anywhere in the SDP. I actually support very much the idea of a combined approach by the chairs of all of the health and wellbeing boards that is being proposed here to get together to go to the minister to outline the concerns that they actually have. And we are trying to get everything better for the people in North Tyneside, because that's what we're here for. But there's a lot of people who are living a lot longer, many more problems that we have. In the Christmas time, the 25% of the people who were actually in hospital were all over 85. That's a disproportionate number of the population. And we need to be looking and addressing that. And, you know, 2 years ago, the Labour government asked all of the other parties to get together and to tackle this issue of social care in the future. And you know they wouldn't do it. Now they're coming along and saying, let's talk about it. It's too late. We should have talked about it 10 years ago, 12 years ago, when we had a Labour government who recognised that there was going to be these issues in the future, and you're short-sighted and you're burying your heads again in exactly the same way as you did then. I certainly hope you don't abstain or vote against it, because it's a real disgrace if you do.
Okay, I'm aware of the time, and I want to give anybody who wishes to speak against the motion an opportunity to do so. Okay, please, I've been informed you have been already replied, it's normally, but I'll give you
Thank you, Chairman. I knew this report would get a great deal of interest from the council members sitting here. And I think that reflects on the great deal of interest that there is out there by our population. The report did what it said it would do. It reviewed the STP, trying to look at the STP and what it was planning to do. We found a lack of information there that we couldn't actually get the full knowledge from the information that we've been given, and we will continue to seek that detail out. There were a few red herrings thrown in there as well, and I think I think that we have indeed completed the task that was set to us. And what I will still say is an excellent report, which totally targets on those issues that we were asked to deal with, and the concerns and the service changes in North Tyneside that affect our population.
Okay, thank you, Robert. Will anyone have any other thoughts?
The result is 48 for, 4 against, and 1 abstention. The no comments are entered yet. Okay, item 8, which is a fair policy statement. Can I ask Councillor Nicholas to make the report?
Thank you, Chair. Council was asked to consider the fair policy statement for 2017-18. This report sets out the background of the fair policy statement, which is an appendix one to the report. It is a legal requirement that the authority publish a fair policy statement by the 1st of April each year, setting out its own policies in relation to the fairest workforce, particularly senior staff and its low-paid employees. The authority recognises its responsibility to its employees and understands the importance of openness and transparency in setting pay and grading. It aims to have clear written policies that ensure decisions on pay are fair, consistent and equitable across the workforce. The attached pay policy statement pulls together what already exists within the authority and how it applies in relation to the statutory requirements of the Localism Act 2011. The key areas of the change from last year's report are the salaries will increase from the 1st of April 2017 in line with the 2 years National Pay Award Agreement effective from the 1st of April 2016 through to the 31st of March 2018. The median average salary has changed from $21,530 to $21,745 per annum. This has not changed the pay model, which continues to report a ratio of 1 to 7. This is well within the government expectations that the pay model relationship should be below 20-1, so we're 2/3 below the government recommendation. And in local government, the average is 15-1, so we're even at half the average of local government. However, we have to be aware that if you look at the private sector, the private issue is 232-1, so I can't be bothered to work that out as a percentage, but it shows how lean we are as an authority on pay. Recognition of the new level of arrangement for self-employed contractors, providing service to the authority under personal service contracts from April 6th of April 2017, the authority becomes responsible for determining the liability for tax and national insurance contributions of these contractors and to ensure the appropriate arrangements are in place for PDYE deductions. The pay policy statement includes most other statements on job evaluation, pay and rating structures, policies and terms and conditions in relation to the remuneration and payment of chief officers. Decisions that the authority has already made in terms of its pay and rating structures are included in the statement, as well as decisions on job evaluation and pay that have been introduced through the collective bargaining process. The decisions on severance pay and the approach to chief officers who may be re-employed by authority now or in the future will be governed by the law and internal policies on redundancy, early retirement and release of pension benefits and equality of opportunity. Thank you.
Carol,
can we
second report?
Yes, second report, Chair.
Okay, are there any questions? Can I invite members to speak to the motion?
Thank you, Chair. We are happy to note this report and in particular welcome the addition of the proposed rules on public sector exit payments. I think the more attention to the use of public funds in this area is very welcome. Indeed, it links to our previous discussion about the NHS where we've seen some huge payments. Locally, I do recall that not long ago some highly paid local NHS executives got exit payments of many hundreds of thousands of pounds and then went on to take over to meet employment elsewhere. It is indeed, I welcome this addition to the report to that implementation in our own pay policy. Thank you.
Okay, anyone wish to speak to the motion? Okay, I'm not going to speak to the vote for the motion. Sorry, please.
That'd be surprising, Debbie, because we have nothing to do with National Health Service. But I thought perhaps one of the ones I do welcome is that from the 6th of April, the authority becomes responsible for determining the liability and tax national insurance cost of these contractors. If you remember, we had a contractor as starting as chief executive under the previous executive and mayor and deputy mayor, Peter Fuller, so I'm glad that that type of abusive system won't be allowed anymore.
Okay,
straight
on. Any questions?
Yes,
Chair.
Yeah.
Okay,
I'm
going to
move
to the
speaker
motion. Can I invite members to speak to the motion?
Any against? Any abstentions on it? Yes, I'm going to. Okay, that's carried. Item 9 is the motions. Motion 1 is signed by Councillors Early, Dorimir and Brandy Lott. I invite Councillor Early to move the motion.
Thank you, Chair. I'm very happy to give the opportunity to move this motion. For many years I was an employee of what's now called the Legal Aid Agency, probably responsible for the administration of legal aid in England and Wales. When I commenced my career there in the late 80s, I would stress I was a very, very young caseworker. I dealt with a range of different legal aid applications. I had one constant to the working day was that caseworkers would be presented each morning with a couple of emergency legal aid applications to consider. These emergency applications were almost without exception for emergency legal aid for domestic violence and abuse cases. Although it was never a pleasant task to begin the day by reading a bit of the environment assault and harassment, the system was simple and it meant that if the caseworker made a decision based upon the contents of the application and the merits of the application, emergency legal aid could be granted instantly. The solicitor could be contacted with the terms of that grant by offering an emergency application for a temporary injunction ex parte that day. In very urgent cases, the solicitor could apply on the telephone. Although it is now some years since I worked in legal aid, my understanding is that the basics of that emergency legal aid system remain in place. And I'm sure that most of us would agree that those who are women who have suffered violent domestic assault or at real risk of doing so should have a method of obtaining immediate access to justice in order to gain legal protection. However, I think this notion speaks to a very real barrier to the ability to urgently gain access to justice for many victims of domestic violence which now are occurring. Since April 2013, victims of domestic violence in legal aid sentencing and punishment of offenders Act 2012 have been required to provide a form of written evidence in order to seek legal aid. The form of this evidence comes from a list of acceptable sources, which currently includes evidence from the police, social services, or health professional. I am aware that the Ministry of Justice has plans to extend the range of acceptable forms of evidence to support legal aid applications, and I think that will prove helpful. However, for the present, the form of evidence which is most often difficult to obtain is supporting medical evidence from the GP. This is not because GPs necessarily find it difficult to provide, but rather because the current regulations allow them to make a charge for its provision. There is a letter of evidence that sits outside the GP and NHS contract, and therefore GPs are entitled to charge a fee prior to the period. Some GP surgeries will not charge us to report, but many will. I'm pleased to say that my understanding is that a number of 29 GP practices in North Tyneside charge a fee. Rather, having spoken to solicitors in some other parts of the Northeast region, some GPs in other parts of the region do charge a fee. This seems to vary between £25 and £100, although other parts of the country charges are as high as £175. And I read on one occasion there and the fee of £300 was charged. Often those are equivalent to a post-COVID operating place. Therefore, it is entirely probable that North Tyneside residents who are registered for GP practice outside of North Tyneside could be faced with the payment of a fee for the full GP's practice letter when seeking legal aid for domestic violence issues. Victims of domestic violence and abuse would often fled their homes in short periods and may have restricted access to finance. These fees often prohibited and a real barrier to access to legal help they need. The survey carried out in 2014, after the changes came into force, concluded that some 43% of victims reported not having prescribed documentation required to successfully apply for legal aid, meaning that they couldn't even get to the first stage of the process, which would mean the solicitor. 46% took no action as a result of not being able to get legal aid, and 25% of victims attempted to represent themselves in court. Whilst this council and the Peace and Crime Commission have and got the right direction to work in supporting victims of domestic violence and attacking domestic abuse, they cannot solve the problem to which this motion refers. The Office of National Statistics reported that in 2013-14, 2.1 million people suffered some form of domestic abuse, 1.4 million women, 8.5% of the population, and 700,000 men, 4.5% of the population. They also recorded, sadly, that on average, 7 women a month are killed by a partner or former partner in England and Wales. Therefore, I believe we should do what we can to ensure victims of domestic abuse get access to justice they require, and after we seek to remove the barriers to prevent them from doing so. That is why I hope that members will join me in supporting this motion to call upon the acting mayor to write to the Prime Minister and ask that the government takes action to support this scheme.
Chair, is there a second on the motion?
I second the motion, Chair.
Wish to speak?
Yes, I do. Thank you, Chair. I'm pleased to support this motion tonight. For both men and women, it takes a great deal of strength and courage to escape domestic abuse. It's estimated that 6.5 million people are or have been victims of domestic abuse. People who suffer domestic abuse are clearly desperate to change their circumstances, but far too many are powerless to act. Nearly half women take no action against their abuser as a result of not being able to apply for legal aid. The government, as we know, is making it more difficult for victims to access legal aid, and as a result, too many dangerous criminals are able to act with impunity. Unfortunately, the government has undermined the pursuit of justice once again by allowing GPs to charge for evidence of domestic abuse, disadvantaging people on low incomes and benefits for those who are under financial control from abusive partners. I hope the majority of doctors do not charge their patients for this documentation, but the government is placing an additional and unnecessary burden on victims. Whether they know it or not, everyone in this room will know someone who has been a victim of domestic abuse, and I hope every councillor tonight supports this really important motion. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, any members who speak to the motion?
Chairman, I have an amendment to the motion.
Chair, can I have some guidance? Does this not fundamentally change the original motion?
That's what's being looked at now.
Give women lifeline to get away from the danger they're suffering. and more importantly, or as importantly, to remove their children who are seeing this sort of lifestyle and often, unfortunately, grow up to think that this is a normal relationship and this is how men and women should treat each other. So I support the motion and time. Thank you.
Judith?
Thank you, Chair. Domestic violence and domestic abuse is absolutely a horrendous issue. We can't support this vote because it's out of date, it's incomplete, and in our view, it's dangerous. The motion's out of date because it's failed to take account of the changes which the government is already making, announced a month ago. Already, the evidence which victims of domestic violence or abuse have to provide isn't restricted to a GP's letter for which there may be a fee. And now the government's extending the range of acceptable evidence which a victim can provide. For example, letters from housing officers, their solicitors, or domestic abuse refuges. This means, fortunately, that it will be much easier for victims to take court action, which is a hugely big step for them. Secondly, the motion is incomplete because it has ignored a further change already announced, and a very, very important change. This is the removal of the 5-year time limit. So evidence can be produced that the abuse has been sustained longer than 5 years ago. Very sadly, Chairman, some abuse goes on for a very, very long time, so it is very important, and I hugely welcome the government's change to that rule. These changes made by the government have been welcomed by the Guardian, as I referred to in my amendment, by the Legal Aid Practitioners Group, and by charities such as Rights for Women, and by the Law Society, which said, relaxing time and evidence restrictions so more victims of domestic abuse can get legal aid for court hearings will be a welcome relief for many people. Meanwhile, the government's decision to protect victims of domestic violence from being cross-examined by their abuser in family courts is another welcome change. That's the Law Society's view. These changes are further evidence, Chairman, of the government's commitment to assisting victims of abuse, and a huge amount of work has already been done by the government. For example, they've strengthened the law on female genital mutilation. It's a crime against children, and abuse of the protection orders are available there, as well as steps being taken to bring a criminal offence to anyone failing to protect a young girl from this abuse. The government's also rolled out the This Is Abuse campaign, which is changing the culture around domestic abuse amongst teenagers. It's very important to start young. Since its rollout in 2010, there's been over 2 million visitors to that website. It's also tackling revenge porn by changing the law to make it clear that people who maliciously distribute intimate pictures of former partners without consent will face a prison sentence. And there's advice and support for those who are victims of that particular type of abuse. And over £80 million has been committed for funding a new violence against women strategy over 4 years, including funding for domestic and sexual violence advisors, helplines and rape crisis centres. And boosting for women's refuges has also been funded. We know, happily, that the number of legal aid applications granted in respect of domestic violence applications has risen by 79% in the last 3 years, as more victims getting the aid that they require. The Prime Minister, Theresa May, made an important speech on this topic on the 17th of February, explaining the new changes and saying that there will be a new Domestic Violence and Abuse Act. It's an area which she has been very active in seeking to help victims. I said, Chairman, that we regard this motion as dangerous, and the reason for this is that by referring image to victims now having to produce a piece of evidence such as a GP's letter, which can cost up to £175, I think the proposal is a scaremongering, and I think it's very concerning. Many victims, as has already been said, won't be able to produce £175 and will be deterred from making an application for legal aid. The motion should recognise that other evidence can be used, and while some GPs may charge, it is believed that only a very small number do. It's set by individual practices, not by the government in any case. The regulations don't refer to a fee at all. To scrap the fee is absolutely pointless. But I'm more concerned, Chair, about the effect of this motion on victims. I have seen abuse for victims in years gone by. I've seen the black eyes, I've seen the broken teeth, I've seen the broken noses, I've seen senior and Council goodwill, and also the psychological harm, often a huge sense of worthlessness which means that victims, very often women, but sometimes men as well, endure horrendous situations for a very long time. I think that by having the inaccuracies in this motion, the motion could be deterring victims from seeking justice. This would prolong their misery, it would prolong the injustice for them and also for their children who are often involved. I hope very much that the proposers, if they come across such cases themselves, either in their board work or in other spheres of life, are making it clear to victims that other evidence is available, other evidence can be produced in support of a legal aid application, and such evidence will not cost money. I'm seriously worried that this motion will be deterring a lot of people, a lot of victims, from making the appropriate application and taking court action. The motion fails to make the position clear, and we cannot therefore support it.
John Harrison.
Thanks, yeah, in support of this motion. I just want to raise the issue regarding children and young people, and just make it clear that, you know, for those young children and young people, find it very difficult and suffer abuse themselves. And I find it difficult to the extent is if they're within a family and that the abuse occurs within that family, the effect that would have on them in their formative years and who did they turn to for advice and for support, and the effect that that would have on them in later years. And when I first read the motion, I started to look into some of the cases of what the impact has been on some of our children and also our younger people. You know, very much the case I read the story of young Laura. She said she's not very old, much happened to me already at a very young age. And there were lots of other children and other mums when she went to a refuge. In other words, there was abuse between the dad and the mum, and she ended up in a refuge. But she went into that refuge, and that started to become her lifestyle. Mother then moves on to a boyfriend. And this is very much the case, is that then that abuse in that violence started within that. So the effect that that has on that young child, and it's a very similar story for a young Zach, who he himself suffering very similar. But when I do look at the effect on some of our younger people, where do they turn to? And who do they turn to? We certainly have a good network within North Tyneside of working with people, and we have in place those supports, I do believe. But the impact on those children, and one of the cases I read was regarding Daisy, and Daisy's story is she's now 22. And when she was younger, and her mum was abused by her dad. There's physical abuse, but mental abuse, and that mental abuse reflected back onto her. Now herself moving into a relationship and moving to her children. So that effect that it has on her. So my plea is, yes, whilst we understand the implications within, if you want, a couple in that partnership arrangement, then those innocent ones, by the side of that, who are abused, and we need to make sure that they are protected, and we need to make sure that we help and we support them. That's my concern, is yes, I'm concerned about abuse, domestic abuse, but in this case, I'm really trying to make a case for children and young people for their consideration of how we help and support them through this very trying time in their lives.
Thank you,
Chair. I'm actually quite surprised with the response over there. They say that it's dangerous or whatever words that were used over there. It's not dangerous for motion, because the fact is, yes, you're all right, there are other ways of getting evidence. But one way of getting evidence is to get GP's letter, which can charge up to £175. Now, on the 5th of February, 16 Police and Crime Commissioners wrote to the Justice Secretary, asking for these charges to be dropped. It's a simple thing. Yes, you're right, there are other places they can go, but to get a medical letter, you have to be charged, or you could be charged, so you could be charged. And that's only a few months ago. So it's not dangerous for us to call and these calls to be scrapped. Now, the reason that these closure in place. And I just found this out, I saw this the other day and I wasn't quite sure, so I wanted to quickly check all the motions were going on. It says on the BMA's website that the reason fees may be charged is because to provide a letter for domestic abuse falls outside the remit of the NHS, therefore GP may charge for the service. Again, if you go to the Legal Aid website, it says what counts as evidence, courts, police, numerous assessments, social services, a letter from a doctor, nurse or health professional. And at the bottom, please be aware that some services may provide, sorry, may need to have a fee attached. So this isn't about, you know, this is, I'm not trying to be political with this one. If anybody is suffering from domestic abuse, there should be no barriers to any form of evidence. That's simply what it is. There shouldn't be a fee attached for any type of evidence. And according to the DMA's website and the Legal Aid website, a doctor's letter may be charged for because it falls outside the agreement with the NHS. I simply don't think that's fair. Alright? Now, Councillor Wells may think that's fair, but that's what it is, not me.
Okay, Alison?
Thank you. Well, I completely agree with what Councillor Wallace had to say about the motion. It only gives a tiny and very selective fraction of information on the whole situation. And the changes to the evidence rules that Councillor Wallace listed will obviously, as I think some of you have admitted, going to be of immense benefit to abuse victims when they're applying for legal aid. There are going to be a lot of sources of free evidence other than a GP's letter. Well, they may or may not charge. Domestic abuse of violence in all its many forms is a very serious problem, but it's one that the Conservative government, not least our Prime Minister Theresa May, has taken decisive steps to deal with. Many measures have been put in place to tackle it. As Home Secretary Mrs. May introduced new domestic violence protection orders to protect victims in the immediate aftermath of an incident of domestic violence. This was launched to coincide with International Women's Day in 2014, and these new powers can stop perpetrators returning to a house or contacting a victim for up to 28 days. And we've also changed the definition of domestic violence to recognise this from the age of 16. On the same day, the government introduced Claire's Law, named after Claire Wood, who was murdered by an ex-partner who had a terrible record of violence that she was unaware of. Under a pilot of the Domestic Violence Disclosure Scheme, which took place over 14 months and across four different police force areas, more than 100 people received what was considered to be potentially life-saving information. Now rolled out nationally, the scheme protects women from potentially abusive and dangerous partners by allowing the police to disclose information about the partner's previous history of domestic violence or violence. The Conservatives have also introduced a new offence for coercive or controlling behaviour, which carries a maximum of 5 years imprisonment for those who are guilty of an offence that amounts to extreme psychological or emotional abuse but stops just short of violence. We've also made forced marriage a criminal offence to send a clear message that it will not be tolerated. Forcing someone to marry against their will in the UK or abroad is now a criminal offence. Victims are rightly protected by the law. We've also introduced new protection for victims of stalking to help keep victims safe at the earliest possible stage. Stalker protection orders will be introduced to offer protection to victims at the first sign of trouble. This builds on the government's work to bring specific stalking events into law and work out stop offenders in advance. To quote the Prime Minister, domestic abuse shatters lives, and this government is working hard to provide police and local authorities with the tools they need to keep women and girls safe. Claire's Law and DVPOs are just two of the raft of measures we've introduced to hand control back to the victim by ensuring that they can make informed decisions about their relationship and escape if necessary.
Excuse me, Chair, can I ask for some clarification from you? Is that a problem? I'm sorry, so I'm just trying to...
No.
Thanks, Chair. Nowhere in this motion does it recognise that there is a lot of evidence that can get, like you say, such as the GP's letter. It doesn't just declare that a GP's letter is the only way that you can get this. you look at every item on there, requires somebody else, but this is medical evidence to prove the physical abuse. Right, and it has to be present, or has to be seen to be present beforehand. I'm quite surprised. This motion simply wants to get rid of one barrier. Everybody should be wanting to get rid of barriers to domestic violence. This is seen as only going to get barriers to domestic violence. Andy referenced the Peace and Crime Commission that goes to the Prime Minister. That wasn't today, our Peace and Crime Commissioners. Those are other Peace and Crime Commissioners, right, the Prime Minister. They should, they can. Now, it is, but the GP search should be straight off, because they're the side of the NHS contract. There is stuff the Justice Minister, other Prime Minister can do, which was referenced in the Justice Committee Select Committee before Christmas. I can't believe that Paris was trying to take down another barrier to get domestic violence victims. Justice is there.
Can I have a right to reply?
Thanks, Chair. I'm a bit scared late in the evening, but we seem to have gone for a looking glass pool where moving barriers to access legal aid in order for victims of domestic violence to obtain support they need to get injunctions. So that seems a bad thing. Just for some clarification, I didn't say that the only form of evidence that was acceptable was a letter from GP. I made reference to a number of other forms. I also referenced that, so that I was aware that the MOJ has plans to extend the range of acceptable forms of evidence. And I did say I thought that would be the next year for on the extension of the time limits that position members have chosen the board, I think it's worth noting that before they agreed to those changes, which aren't yet implemented, they had to be dragged through the courts by various women's groups and legal aid groups, in effect forced to make those changes. And when it comes to scaremongering, I can say that legal aid, these reports were charged with £175. As I said, the information I've gathered from local solicitors, the charge in the North East region was somewhere between £25 and £100, but there were definitely evidence of the reports. In other areas, they could have been charged for £175. So, again, I repeat, I cannot see how anybody can be against supporting a motion that asks for barriers to justice for those suffering horrendous domestic violence and abuse to be removed. Just seems counterintuitive to argue to me that that could be dangerous. And I will request the meeting for the government's motion.
Okay, I'll go to the end roll now. Yeah.
and that answer the questions in writing.
Okay, next resolution, can I invite Councillor Johnson and the motion?
Thank you, Chair. Newcastle Airport is absolutely crucial in our region where that rebounds the economy. It's vital to bring this to our borough and our region, but also those businesses in the north and struggle internationally. It's crucial that the airport continues to grow and maintain key routes in the economy in the north east of Europe. The strategic economic plan for our North East Local Enterprise Partnership identifies enhanced international links as crucial to the future growth of our region. The airport currently supports nearly 8,000 jobs in the region and contributes £43 million to the regional GDP every year. It's therefore concerning that the Scottish Government, which now has the ability to control the airport's territory through the enhanced devolution powers to gain before the Scottish referendum, can't use these powers to replace the airport's territory in Scotland with an air departure tax. This tax will see a cut of 50% in this town compared to airports in the EU. And the government have committed to abolish, the Scottish government have committed to abolish this tax completely when conditions are up. This is a real concern for our region as government departments and local stakeholders have identified that the reduction of ABD in Scotland will have serious impact on economic prosperity of Newcastle Airport and South Scotland for our region. It is estimated that the tax that was abolished in Scotland, Newcastle Airport would lose between 500,000 and 900,000 passengers per year. This is not sustainable, and see the future economic development of our region is going to be very concerned in the future. While the government has tried to do something, it did freeze air passage for 5 years on short routes and make minor changes to long routes. Let's go on the ball state meeting, these changes will not be a drop in the ocean compared to the money loss. When David Campbell was the Prime Minister, he said, the valuation of air passage in Scotland, stop competition and see businesses drawn off the ball, with a huge impact on airports and the rest of the country. We're reviewing the way air passenger dream works to make sure that cities don't lose out. We are not going to accept a situation where there's an unfair tax competition. We will do whatever's necessary to make sure England's regional airports can succeed. It was therefore very disappointing in the last 2 quarters has been no long-term plan to find a solution for regional airports. When Scotland cuts ABD later this year, because it's now enjoying favour in Scottish Health with the SNP and the Tories Scotland Alliance. It's still certain to state that the current position of Newcastle Airport is that they won't review the ABD until after Brexit. The North East cannot afford to wait until after Brexit to see this result. The government must stick to its commitment to allow England regional airports to succeed and give a long-term commitment to solve this issue for Newcastle Airport and the rest of the regional airports. Thank you.
Councillor Newman, second.
There's a couple of key things I want to point out there. We can't wait until after Brexit, as the new Scottish air departure tax will receive a royal assent on the 23rd of March 2016. So by the time Brexit negotiations and talks are over, it will already be live and we'll be then backpedaling and fighting what's already happened. So we kind of need to have a bit of forethought rather than being reactionary. Key thing we're saying about loss of investment, okay, if we stabilise people from going to Newcastle Airport, for instance, a long haul flight for a couple will cost them £150 more. Are you going to pay £150 more to go to Newcastle? Are you going to hop in the car and go to Edinburgh Airport and possibly save £150 or for a bit of better travel, nice bit of travel? If that happens and we start losing routes, there's quite a wide sort of thing to look at here. You've got the direct jobs of the airport, you've got the baggage handlers, you've got the support staff inside the airport, but you've also got the export market to think about. Export market's going to be quite an important thing going forward, because planes don't just carry people, they carry the goods and services underneath the aircraft as well, which you don't normally realise when you sit there in the comfortable chair flying wherever you're going to go to. So we can't have Brexit kicking things in the long grass here. We do actually have to think about this up front and get something in there. And what can the government do? Well, Newcastle Airport, I know, have had discussions and at least proposed at least three different things. They could announce any reductions in Scotland will be matched across the rest of the country. You could reduce ABD across the whole country, thereby making it more expensive for Scotland to undercut New England and Wales. Or introduce a congestion-based approach where non-congested airports have a lower rate of ABD. So there are solutions out there and there are options which I believe other people have come up and suggested. I say, I can't understand why anybody in this chamber would have a problem saying the government back in 2013 made it quite clear that they wouldn't allow competition to stabilise the rest of the UK. So I look forward to the whole chamber being in this agreement.
Thank you. Anybody wish to speak against the motion? Okay, I'm going to bring the move on right to the
back. Okay.
Okay, that's one vote on those in favour. That's unanimous. Thank you. I'm abstaining or anything? Thank you, John. Item 10, can we bring a coming seal?
Okay.
Item 11, chairs announcements. It's getting late, so I'll go now. Item 12, the mayor's announcements.
Well, certainly, Chair, because it's late in my last council meeting after 4 years, I'm back also. Thank you very much. As part of the announcements, I think I'd like the opportunity to reflect on the last 4 years. You may recall that when I was 11 in 2013, I was faced with the situation of having to make, on the first day, 12 and a half million pounds worth of cuts because a significant proportion of the budget had not been found and was confirmed by the previous administration. I think you'd agree it wasn't the best situation to walk in on your first day in the office. In addition to this, there were proposals in place to close some libraries, some of our libraries, charge for waste collection, give away the ownership of our leisure centres, and that was greeted by two privatisation deals were in place very, very quickly to deliver our services. I was informed on that day, our first day, that our bin wagon keys needed to be replaced. Since 2013, we have scrapped the plan to close our libraries, didn't charge for waste collection, we stopped the handover of our leisure centres, and reviewed the contract based with our partners in order to get a better deal for our taxpayers. This is on top of having to pay £58.68 million for the savings. £58 million between 2013 and 2017. Yet, despite these unprecedented cuts, we have achieved a great deal. I would like, therefore, to like this, take this opportunity to thank my colleagues in the Cabinet, my group members, and of course our Chief Executive, and all of our staff for the hard work in delivering our priorities. And I have to say they were priorities which were identified by the residents of North Tyneside. They weren't my vanity projects, they were identified by the residents of North Tyneside. Our residents told me they wanted jobs and apprenticeships for young people. When I told a group of people last week that the numbers they were asking could not believe it. So I'm therefore delighted to say that we have created 6,796 jobs in the last 4 years, 7,680 apprenticeships. And that's not through this government, this is through the hard work of the people and our staff in North Tyneside. In addition to this, Co-op is now 90% occupied and is home to 14,000 employees. This is an increase of 5,000 employees since 2013. Core is now 65% occupied. Our residents also told me that there was a need for affordable homes. Therefore, I'm very pleased to say that our whole affordable homes program, which aims to deliver 3,000 new homes by 2024, is on track. As we approach the end of the third year of the program, we will have helped to deliver 850 new homes by the end of the month. These homes are in addition to the 900 fully refurbished or new retirement apartments and bungalows in our sheltered housing accommodation for our older residents. Our residents also expect me their sadness at the sorry state of our house
Coast Line and surround town centres, which have been neglected for many, many years, and in some cases left quite in the matter of eyesores. I'm pleased to say that if you now travel along the coastline, there is a great deal of evidence of regeneration taking place. The Highcourt Hotel, the Whiskey Bend, the Beaumont Avenue Public House have disappeared and they will be replaced by new residential homes. Work to the dome has begun. That had been elected for many, many years, over 20 years now. The work is well underway, and this will see the restoration of the Spanish City Dome as the centre for a piece of major investment, and will also see Central Local and Northern Promenade improved. And I want to talk about the Central Promenade because I can remember, and I need to make this very, very clear. I didn't sign a contract, nor did I agree the design of the Central Promenade. That was agreed before I ever came into office. What we did do, we listened to the residents because they weren't happy with it. They didn't like the design. We got a new design, we went into consultation, and then we actually found a way to retender. Thanks to some of my colleagues. And because of that, we saved the council £4 million. In North End Town Centre, we have secured a major improvement to the Forum Shopping Centre, working with the owners to bring forward development to the new supermarket and other new retail facilities. Residents have told me that they are delighted to have their own supermarket after 10 years of waiting. I'm pleased to say derelict building replaced with new modern homes. We have made considerable progress at Swans over the last 4 years. This is included clearance of redundant buildings, remediation of the site, provision of new roads and infrastructure both within the site and improvements to roads leading to it, dredging two pockets of the quay side to accommodate deep water vessels. And I have to thank our MP, Mary Glindon, because it took us months and months and months to get permission from this building, right? To dredge the River Tyne. We created a centre for innovation and a business centre. We reinforced the security of the site. We are now focusing on strengthening the quay to ensure it meets with the industry standards to accommodate the cranes. I want to make this very clear too. The agreement about the crane had nothing to do with me, something I picked up when it came in. I was told by officers that there had been a deal agreed by the previous chief executive, not this one, the previous mayor, and some company. So I picked up that problem when I walked in that first week. Yes, we will deliver the crane when the key side is qualified to take it, because the business has told us that we want it. But make it quite clear, I didn't agree that deal. As the Swans Innovation Centre, I want you to know that 810 of the offices are occupied with the creation of 40 jobs. Two companies have come down there from Aberdeen. In North Youth Town Centre, we are putting together ambitious plans for the Trent Centre, starting with the redevelopment of the vacant properties in North Square, Northern Square. We have spent over 9.2 million in the last 4 years on roads and pavements. The previous Conservative administration only spent 6.8 million in their 4 years. And I agree there's still much to do. And that's where you've included 6 million into the budget over the next 3 years. Like all of us here, I hope you are extremely proud of our schools in North Tyneside. 90% of our primary schools are in the top 10% of the country. The majority of our schools are classed as good or outstanding. And would you believe, one of our high schools is one in the top 10 schools in the country. Top 10, one of our high schools. And I would like to thank all those staff who teach and support our children in well. I'm sure you will agree with me that North Tyneside is a great borough in which we live, and we have achieved national recognition. This year, we were awarded 5 prestigious green flags for our parks, we have a thing in Minnesota, and 3 blue flags and 4 seaside awards for our beaches. The council has not done this on their own. This has been achieved through partnership working with the support of our businesses, the community and voluntary sector in the borough, let alone our own council staff, who have worked tirelessly and professionally to deliver an excellent level of service to our residents from North Tyneside. It is disappointing, however, to see people criticising our staff, their representatives in the press. After all, without their support and cooperation, we could not achieve the things we have. I'm sure you will all agree that the past 4 years have been an exciting journey, because I've been excited, and we have achieved many, many great achievements. But there is still more to do. I still want North Tyneside to be an area that people are proud to live in, work in, and call their home. I started this journey. I have made much progress along with my colleagues, and I'm determined to see it through. I would like to make this particular opportunity to make it very, very clear that I am not shouted around this borough in a Jaguar. I drive this borough around this borough on my own in a red Fiesta, would you believe? I also want it to be very clear that what we have achieved in the last 4 years are not my vanity project. They are the things that the residents told me they were concerned about. It is important to them that we work on their behalf. And I can assure you, nothing I have reported to this council this evening is slick spin. No spin there at all. It is real, actual fact.
Thank you very much, Chair, for being here. Thank you.
Both of them, I have a big confidence
the officers have fully considered all the environmental and economical issues associated with the legal replacement, and selected the most appropriate solution for North Tyneside Council. The new civic car has a Euro 6 engine, which is designed to reduce harmful pollutants from the vehicle exhaust. The aim of Euro 6 is to reduce levels of harmful car and van exhaust emissions, both in petrol and diesel cars. Importantly, the knock-on effect of reducing these pollutants means to improve fuel economy and lower CO2 emissions. Therefore, I do not share compulsion to regret.
And your supplements?
I have, Jim. At the time of purchasing the new civic car, was the mayor aware that diesel exhaust is damaging to health? The Ministry of Transport advises the public not to purchase diesel cars in both London and Birmingham are to restrict entry of diesel cars into their cities. Was she also aware that North Tyneside civic car duty is ideally suited to electrical propulsion? If she was, why on earth did she elect to purchase the polluting diesel Jaguar car rather than a cleaner electrical car?
I've already said the car had a Euro 6 engine, which is put to very down. Now, we're going on to the sort of electric car we're talking about. Some of the journeys in North Tyneside are multiple journeys a day. You can actually go from one meeting down in Torrington and up to another one in Zurich. The Nissan E, with the smaller engine, you only do 120 miles on one battery. The larger engine, which you can get up to 155 kilos, but that can be changed by a little bit of feature. Actually, if the weather's hot, it's pretty cool, the battery's not as efficient. Also, if you do a journey at night with the lights and the heater on in the cold weather, you don't get anything like that. So I think you can understand that we wouldn't be, how would you like to be sitting in Durham waiting for a meeting and saying, well, can you wait about that so you charge up again? Because we can't get there for another 4 hours. I mean, that's how long it takes to charge a car. I think we wouldn't have been able to manage with it. But sometimes, not that I listen here, but one of the people, actually, the cars actually had to go to London. Well, how many times did you have to stop going down to London in an electric car? And if you're looking at hybrid ones, actually, the hybrid car, the Prius, actually, you only get 30 miles on the battery, the rest of it going to the fuel. So I think when we looked at all of these things, and actually came up with the best alternative, sort of lean, mean Jaguar.
Question three, Councillor Hudson,
you bring it, Chair. Could the Mayor update Council concerning the combined authorities' uncertainty as to whether to work with the government in order to gain greater independence and authority for the region or not?
Thank you, Councillor Hudson. I'm pleased to do that. On the 6th of September 2016, I majority 4 members to 3. The North East Combined Authority voted not to proceed with the North East Devolution Deed that had been agreed with government on the 23rd of October 2015. Since then, the three authorities who voted to proceed with the Devolution Deal, Newcastle, Northumberland and ourselves, have been working together on the potential Devolution Deal for Northumberland Tyne, and we have started formal negotiations with the government.
No, I haven't. Thank you.
Okay, question four.
Could the Mayor inform Council as to the combined authorities' plan of action by which to secure the best possible Brexit results for the North East of England, including North East?
In the absence of any clear plan of action from the government, together with clear indications of the impact for local authorities, there is only very limited work that can be done either in the North East or North Tyneside level. The North East Combined Authority has stated publicly that the North East has seen significant benefits from membership of the European Union in the form of access to European trade and investment and through European funding. which has helped to regenerate our towns and cities and support business, invest in science and support our rural economy. And there is clear concern about the potential loss of the European funding. In September 2016, the Combined Authority over the Human Scrutiny Committee added the impact of Brexit to their work programme. Also, at an officer level, the economic directors group have put in place a significant programme of work looking at the impact of Brexit on the economy, local authority finances, and the region more widely. The North East Combined Authority, their governance committee, has also identified the risk around future funding uncertainties following the EU referendum.
Thank you, Mayor. Can I sort of does the Mayor agree that Council needs to be routinely informed about decisions made by the Combined Authority in a more formal way than members' questions to the Mayor, especially with regard to Brexit developments?
I agree with it. As soon as I know anything regarding Brexit, I will tell Council or inform the Council.
Question for Angela.
Since fishing has been an important industry in North Tyneside and will be even more important once we leave the European Union, what is the elected mayor doing to encourage that industry?
I recognise the importance of the fishing industry both in terms of its economic benefits and its place in North Tyneside heritage. We have worked hard with colleagues in North London and the members of our fishing community over the last year or so. To secure funding from the European Maritime and Fisheries Fund. The 800,000 funding will support community-led local development in fishing communities through a plan which is Fisheries Global Action over the next 3 years. This shows that not only are we very successful in attracting inland investment to cobalt, cod and swan, but those are committed and recognise they are traditional our communal support. We will continue to explore other means to assist the fishing industry going forward and monitor the impact of Brexit. The key focus of Bunty will be to support the area to adapt to the reformed common fisheries policy and to maximise economic growth opportunities within the fisheries and aquaculture sectors. Four initial priorities have been identified for the use of the funding. Development of a small-scale infrastructure at port and harbour, marketing, branding and processing, training, retention, recruitment and diversification, collaborative and applied research between fishermen and scientists. However, we must also recognise the lack of uncertainty beyond North Tyneside as we look to central government to see their vision for the fishing industry. We are all aware that this will have a huge impact. And all we can do at this stage is offer the support we can locally. Perhaps, Councillor Wallace, you could ask the Prime Minister from his view as it will ultimately be up to central government to decide on the future of the fishing industry.
Since fishing is of huge importance, and I agree with that, since fishing is of huge importance, and we're agreed on that, do you agree with me that it was surprising and disgraceful that the fishing industry, fishing and even fish, has not been mentioned once since 2012 in the House of Commons by the Labour Shadow Minister for Environment, Food and Rural Affairs, North Tyneside MP, Mrs. Glindon?
I would
just like to make a comment. I was elected to represent the residents of North Tyneside, the industries of North Tyneside, and the works people here in North Tyneside. I have no power whatsoever at what happens at the local level, except at the national level, except in the and I sometimes I'm taken behind the back by some of the remarks you've covered on that. It really is most upsetting. Sometimes we have to have respect, sometimes we stay at a level where we respect each other, and sometimes it really does upset me that you can lower
Yeah, no, that's the record that was mentioned, but you've got more right to come in with this.